All right, welcome back, Savitz.
Well, hello there, Savitz.
Just in time.
I wonder what you were doing.
Well, welcome back, guys. I'm pretty sure you got some coffee, Savitz. Well, so we're going to head back into our second match of today, Foursome Boys versus Nilam. How are you guys doing today, and what do you think about this upcoming match? Savitz, start with you, since you're so eager to get back to casting.
Yeah, I can't wait for this. We saw some amazing stuff, like the challenge, what's it called? Mysterious Challenger Paladin. It didn't work out so well, but it was really exciting to watch. And Foursome Boys and Team Nihilum. Nihilum especially, I think out of all the teams in the league, they have potentially put the most preparation into their matches. I know that those guys really think hard. They think as a team, they discuss strategy as a team. I'm excited to see how they are going to utilize the new cards. Foursome Boys, I would imagine we're going to see Patron Warrior, Freeze Mage, something like some of the old stuff, but they might also innovate. And we see shamans here right away from both teams.
Oh.
And there's actually two shamans from Team Nihilum, which is probably graphic error.
Shaman is too good. All right, we're going to have to fix that up because that is obviously incorrect. They cannot do that. So hopefully we got that sorted. But yeah, it seems like shaman is going to be a pick for both classes. And what are we missing from normal? We actually have no druids at all.
Oh,
that's fair. I'm actually really excited to see these shamans because there's like so many variations of mid-range shaman these days. Like, I've seen some lists not even play Totem Golem, for example. I know, like,
really?
Loyan. Well, you know Loyan, Savitz. Loyan or 11.5.
Yeah.
He actually plays a list without Totem Golem.
Amazing. Yeah, it is a bit clunky. We talked about it a little bit before the previous match. That sometimes on early turns, when you play it on turn 2, it makes you hero power on turn 3, and that's not something you want to do. So it's a bit clunky in that sense. But it also, it lets you get that early minion out there. It contests things like juggler really well, kills it off while still surviving. It's a powerful card. I think it's a good card, but I can understand some players not choosing to play it.
Yeah, not only that, but you have the options to play like Mistcaller or like the 3/6 that buffs your other totems. It's just in quite a bit of flux right now. I know that both Oskaka and RDU have favored Mech Shaman in the past, but with the advent of all these new mid-range decks, I feel like Mech Shaman is slightly worse these days.
Yeah, I think it's more likely that we're going to see some of the new Shamans, but I wouldn't completely rule it out that we're going to see some Mechs too. I don't think the deck would anyhow be too bad, but the main thing is that there's not that many new things for the mech decks to really run. Like, how do you improve a mech shaman with the new cards?
Yeah, well, there is a mech that, it's a 5/5 that gives +1/+1, but it's not, like, that amazing, especially in an aggressive deck.
Yeah, it fights for the same spot. You can't really run both Feldreaver and that, and Feldreaver on its own is already so amazing that I don't think that the new 5/5 would be that big of an improvement. And speaking of shaman, we're gonna see the shaman straight away from Oskaka.
All right, shaman versus... Oh, and yeah, we did fix the double shaman. It's, of course, Taish playing druid. I actually would be pretty surprised if Taish didn't play druid. So there is a druid in this series, and Oskaka has been known for bringing a very mech shaman or like a very aggro shaman in the previous weeks. But now that TGD is out, do you think that Oskaka is actually going to, you know, change the shaman gear plan up?
Definitely possible. Oskaka is a player who is more known for perfecting the gameplay on some of the lists instead of coming up with a lot of weird and wacky decks. He tends to go back to his comfort picks quite often, but with TGD out, it's interesting to see.
Well, I feel like out of all these six players, I feel like they're all six of them are fairly standard. I know like Life Coach does innovate, but he's not the kind of player who would innovate a deck on like day two of TGT. He's like the kind of guy who would like spend 2 weeks and then play a deck that he's been like perfecting for a long time. Meanwhile, Oskaka, pretty standard. Tice is also a very standard player. RDU is slightly less standard. And I think out of all six, Chalky is probably the one who's most likely to innovate some decks.
I think so too, yeah.
But RDU does bring some very wacky decks.
Yeah.
Who?
RDU brings a lot of wacky decks. You know, we saw like, didn't we see in the one tournament where he brought like Narubar Ambusher to it, and they were like, "Whoa, what the heck is that doing there?"
And Ardu was also one of the first ones to play the aggro paladin when it still wasn't that popular. I'm not sure if it was the first one, but one of the first ones for sure to play it in a competitive environment.
Mm-hmm. Well, go ahead.
Yeah, I think he actually was the very first one.
It's quite possible. Thais Druid, I would imagine that it's going to be something with double combo still, but some new cards should be in there. Maybe the Living Roots and Aspirant, at least one, probably two. There are things that you can do with the new cards. We saw Hyped earlier on today play the new 4-drop, the what's it called? The 5-4?
Savage Combatant.
Yeah. So if Hyped thought that it's worth playing, maybe Thais has come to the same conclusion.
Ooh, Skaka is going to stick with his guts, I guess, and bring the very aggressive Mech Shaman. And I think it's actually a good matchup against the Druid, no matter what Druid it is.
Alright.
Just against standard Druid, it's has a record of 15-6, so that's 71%.
Yeah, that's so good for the Shaman.
That is the dream opening, right?
Yeah. And Thais doesn't really have the cards that he wants right now. He wants the Innervate, he wants the Wild Growth, he wants the Aspirant, he wants the Living Roots, if he put it in the deck. I could imagine that maybe somebody doesn't like the Living Roots, but personally I think it's quite amazing. I would be running to in my Druid, and maybe consider taking out Rath if you want to take something out. Oh, there we go. And he does have it now in his starting hand.
Alright, so do we expect any new cards in Oskaka's deck?
No. Might not be. I don't think there's going to be any. I don't know, like what would you really put in, Shaman?
Like, all the new cards are essentially like, they make totems, which isn't really like, it doesn't have any mech synergy, for example. I like all these new additions to Druid decks, like the Living Roots and the Aspirant, because they give like Druid more options to contest the early game, and I feel like it makes Druid more consistent while still keeping the power level at around the same level.
I think so too. It's so amazing here. Normally in this matchup, it's like you have to coin a Wrath to deal with that, or the Gogmaster is going to add up to something ridiculous like 9 or even 12 damage. That Living Root here, allowing Thais to deal with it, and not only deal with it, but to keep the coin. That's a big deal.
Yeah, previously in in Shaman versus Druid matchups, Druids just can't deal with a one drop very effectively, right? I mean, coining a Wrath, do you feel that good about that? Not really.
No, it's horrible. It doesn't even break even. You have to use the coin, and the coin is for Druid. It's a big deal.
Mm-hmm. And so here we go. This is actually a real mash. Thanks for Living Roots. Oh, there it is.
What does he get out of it? Imagine if it's like a flame tongue.
Oh, man. Imagine. That is a great card for Oskaka. And wow, Tash is just like the biggest upside down frowner. Oh, my God.
That was so huge. If Oskaka, first of all, if he didn't draw that totemic, his turn would have been Hero Power Pass.
Right.
It's been so horrible. Now instead, he topics the totemic, and not only that, but he gets a good totem out. Look at that rot going down on the free minion, basically. Wow.
Oh man, what a turnaround.
And what is this fire god gonna be?
Yeah, this fire god could be really big.
Yeah, will Oskaka keep getting this amazing RNG on his totems and his just random rolls that Shaman always has?
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you're always lucky, you play Shaman.
That's true. Like, you have the crackles, you have the lightning storms, everything is kind of like everywhere.
Wow. So. Six is like almost certainly the best.
Six. Yeah, I mean, in this situation, since there's no big Game Hunter in Thais' hand right now, the 7 would have been even a tiny bit better, but that 6 is so amazing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, an extra option here. You can actually route Biter into Spider Tank instead to clear, but then you're playing Fish Shaman, right? You do not want to clear, so just roll again.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Keep going, Fish. Let's see if he gets another. Okay, that's a bit of a worst result. But still, Ostkaka kind of dominating position.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost impossible for the Druid to clear at this point. Druid of the Claw, it's so bad.
I mean, yeah.
It's so bad against that 6-6. Like, do you charge it or something? No, I guess you just have to play it and let it die to the 6-6. Try to find like some kind of clear next turn. Wow.
This cannot feel good from Taish.
Man,
Skaka's feeling pretty happy about himself here. Lightning Bolt is gonna be more burn.
Wow, that's even better. I think use the spells to clear it. Go face for 10, play the spider tank.
Well, would you roll a spell power here? It's like a perfect Lava Burst turn, right? But oh, I get what you mean. You know, Lightning Bolt and the Rock Rider is actually a pretty decent.
Yeah.
I do like that the most.
It even improves his board position. It's the same damage that you get to go to face, but you get to keep your minion at full health too.
Mm-hmm.
Then having a 4-6, 6-6, and a 3-4, what can Druid even do? Even if Druid had the perfect cards, there's almost no way to get rid of those.
Okay, Skaka's gonna see that play and does that after a little bit of thinking. And yeah, like you said, board is insane.
Oh my.
Alright, yeah. Taj needs to find something insane in the Shredder. I think that's how you get back in the game.
How insane can it be?
And Norishaw would be a good start, actually.
Oh, wow, that would pull a lot of weight. I mean, if he was to get that.
Oh, actually, would Dire Wolf be good? Or, like, Flametongue be good? Oh!
Flametongue would have... No. Not enough. This is lethal right now with the Lava Burst.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, Oskaka's just gonna burn the first smash down and put the first series to Force and Boars really, really quickly.
Just like that. Wow. That turn 3 that taught me. I think that was like the moment in the game where it just like Oskaka took such a huge lead. There was not much that that Tice could do anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we were kind of speculating on what new TG.
ETB card
destroyers. ETB cards would be in that deck, and I think that totemic it makes a lot of sense because you have you have the Fire Guard destroyer initially, right? So that's like just an overall really good card on average, and you might as well add the Tuskar totemic because it's like a similar concept.
Yeah, what do you think he got for it? Maybe the power maces or
no? I think power maces are the reason you play Mech Shaman.
Okay, so you definitely want to keep those. I mean, it's quite powerful, that's true. So, but there was still the spider, thank you. So maybe he got on the higher end, like something like Fire Elementals made it a bit faster on that sense, or Dr. Boom.
It seems like the Broom deck.
I think the original version,
Yeah, doesn't use any Fire Elementals or Dr. Booms to begin with anyways. So maybe cutting Leroy would be a thing.
Okay.
Yeah, cutting Leroy, maybe the second Doomhammer, perhaps.
Yeah, it makes sense, because I feel like a lot of these games are... When you're playing Mech Shaman, it's so important to curve out nicely, and when you get to those later turns, even Doomhammer turns, the game might already be decided. So you have to run away with the game early, so you just have to improve your chances to curve out nicely.
Alright.
So, yeah, I've played so many Mech Shaman games where it just you feel like the game the deck defeats itself by not having a drop on one of the early turns.
Yeah, definitely one of the weaknesses of the deck. And also just like, even if they do curve out, it seems like their minions overall are slightly weaker than other decks.
Yep.
Yep, exactly.
Seems like Monk is just going to go in and out. Oh man. We should have a bet on like how long it will take to get Monk to actually fix his connection. Because this happens quite often, but yeah, we're just gonna have to wait till players choose their decks. Currently, they are they get to have like 1 minute between each game to select their decks, and see who's gonna step up to the plate. Force and Boars off to a great start. I think the what do you call it when you have a new deck that comes up and you win with it? That's just amazing because like. If Oskar's Shaman actually lost the game, then Nihilum would actually expect to see that kind of deck and would be prepared for it, right?
Yeah, the surprise factor of the new cards is kind of out of the window then. I mean, I'm not saying that there's the much counterplay that you can do to when you know that there's a Tusker Totemic, but maybe in some other scenarios, if there's more like more tech type of cards where the more situational cards. If you lose a game with a new deck with situational cards, your opponent's knowing that it's in there, it might be a very valuable information.
Mm-hmm. Now we see Forsen's gonna step up to the plate with Warlock. And RDU is the one to be playing Shaman this time around.
Oh yeah, wow. Yeah, I'm not even gonna guess what it is. It could be absolutely anything.
Yeah, RDU is definitely gonna play anything. And Forsen, well, Forsen did play a lot of Zoo. There was one week he actually played the Handlock to kind of, you know, mix it up. But otherwise, yeah. I don't think Zoo got a lot of love in the TGT cards, right, Savage?
No, there was the discard mechanic thing, which could potentially spawn like a new archetype of aggressive Zoo. But I kind of doubt that Forsen would ever like deck a deck like that so fast. So my guess would be that it's a fairly standard Zoo from Forsen.
Oh, and I guess there's a Power of Warming that we just missed. Whoa!
Impaler! Okay. Well, if there's one deck that you played in, I guess it makes sense to play in this one because of the implosion mainly and other mechanics too, like Haunted Creepers if you have those. Wow, what a stock, RDU.
Well, this might be pretty different. We'll have to see. Doomguard is not really what Forsen wants to see this early on.
No.
Yeah, this Gormok doesn't seem like it's gonna proc either. I guess Gormok does make sense, right? You have, you know, a lot of Death Rattle creatures. You also have the Implosion, which actually activates it immediately.
Yeah. Let's see if RDU can pick up another mech.
Oh, man!
Oh! It's usually the matchup is pretty rough for Mech Shaman, but this board, Zoo doesn't really run any AoE. Like, how does Forsen clear this?
Look at Forsen's face, that's hilarious.
Never am I ever lucky.
Oh, just looking at this board, it's like, what just happened?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
Good when the stakes are so high when you see your opponent go off like that.
Oh, how about Flame Totem? Oh, man.
Sounds pretty good.
You don't say. Alright, so we just put it in we're directly in the middle of everything, and then we can have the MechWarper trade for the Voidwalker. And then, oh wow! Ashes just gonna push for all the damage in the world.
Turn 3 and the entire hand is played from
turn 3,
from
right? Alright.
Wow.
Oh.
Maybe a Forsen deck in a Hellfire. Nope. That's not it.
Is that a good game?
Lava
Burst top deck? Do it. One time. Oh, that's fine too. Come on.
Yeah.
3 mana, 8/8. Casually just play that. Seems fine. Yeah.
Maybe like a.
Ooh, no trades. Okay, that might be a little bit greedy, but I guess you have so much burn in your deck, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah. Implosion, not helpful. I think that's just game. I mean, there's no way to stop the Fellraiser, is there?
Let's see. You can play Abusive into Wolf, and it actually clears the Fellraiser, thereby summoning the Doomguard, right? So you Abusive, a 1/1, you Wolf, and then the 1/1 clears the. The Inertron, and then you clear the Fellraiser with the rest.
You could actually play the Impaler here too. After Abusive into Impaler.
Yeah, but then you don't. Is it actually that good?
I don't know. Hold on. Wait. Just to see how this.
What are you actually impaling? Well, I guess. Whoa! What? Wait. What?
No, that was a mistake.
Wait, no, that what?
I think he was planning to impale there.
No,
he's pausing.
Wait, no.
Yeah!
No, Forsen? Forsen?
No!
Not how it works! Oh, man! Oh! Whoops. Well, I guess to be fair, he was gonna lose anyways, but...
He's gonna lose anyway, that's true.
Yeah, but still, that was pretty funny.
Yeah, that was brutal.
Wait, was there actually a way to remove lethal off the board, though?
I was never even planning to do the Impaler. At that point, it's like, nobody knows anything.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure there wasn't, but still pretty funny. That was actually the thing. I mean, there's one thing to saying that you want to keep Gormok, right? To like show it off later, but it seems like Force did want to play it, but it didn't really work. So, yeah. Well, the first game that ended up so quick.
Yeah, the double mech warp and draw, it's just like anybody who has played with mech shaman or against mech shaman, when that thing happens, there's not much you can do to stop it, really. Unless you play like Handlock with a double Hellfire. Not even Consecration is not enough. There's very few AoEs that I can actually deal with those things in time. Hellfire might even be the only thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go. Both shamans are going to receive a 100% win rate in our first day of ATLC. And we're not going to see those decks anymore because, they're just mech shamans. And they got two very, very, well, I wouldn't say very, very good matchups. I think RDA just drew the nuts there. It's pretty hard to beat the nuts.
Yeah. It sure is. Mech shamans, out of all the shamans. I don't want to say I'm disappointed, but I guess I have to. I mean, I wouldn't see the mid range. I wanted to see how do you build it. But it's understandable. With so much on the line, it's a pretty brave thing to do. Maybe a little bit too brave to just based on two days of TGD to bring out something completely new. So we can't really blame them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just that everyone has different opinions about what's good in midrange shaman. That there's no consensus. There's like no one has like logicked it out to its entirety yet, to its finality.
Yeah, exactly. I'm 100% sure that there's going to be some kind of shaman which we might see maybe in a few weeks, maybe in a month, maybe in 2 months, that will be competitive, will work, at least in some meta. Maybe not in all the metas. There might be some, for example, like Freeze Mage meta, it might be not a very good time to bring that because of the way that it works and the way that you can possibly get destroyed by AoE. But it should have its good matchups.
Well, here we go. We're moving on to the third game where, I think it's actually only the Warlock and the Druid that's different in the teams, right? So we already know that Force is running Zhu, and we already know that Taish is running the Living Roots Druid, you know, kind of typical Druid. And everything else is still a mystery, I guess.
That is true. I wouldn't say it for sure, but if I was a betting man, I would bet on both of the warriors being still patrons.
Okay. Yeah.
And I would also bet on Life Coach bringing a more control-y paladin, while Chalky brings a more aggro paladin.
That's also a good bet, actually.
Could be.
And I feel like if Chalky brought the aggro paladin to this match, he got the best matchup possible. Because I've been talking to him about these matchups for aggro paladin, and he says like the remainder of the decks in Nilum's lineup, which are the Freeze Mage, the Druid, and the Patron Warrior, or at least three of those, they're really favored against the paladin.
Mm-hmm. This is interesting because both of these players, they could be playing anything, but just based on their play styles, they're the exact opposites. Life Coach tends to drift towards the late game slow decks, and Chalky loves to go face.
Yep. I mean, when's the last time you've seen Life Coach run Zhu over Handlock, right? Kind of also fits their personalities as well. And there we go, exactly.
Yeah.
Or imagine Argent Horse Rider does go face, and Life Coach's Sludge Belcher is a defensive card. So there you go.
Wow. Okay. Duskar Joestar. It's going to be very important for Life Coach to win the joust eventually. But this hand from Life Coach, it's looking pretty bad. Not just pretty bad, it's looking terrible. The first play he has will be on turn 4. But he might end up top decking, he might find a shielded minibot. Master for battle, but he really needs those cards right now. Ooh!
That's pretty good. That is actually...
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely the best thing he could have even hoped for.
But now, of course, we have to see some juggles. That first one missed, that's not really that good. And there we go, that's okay.
The second
one,
yeah.
Still going for face.
That's exactly how he wanted the juggles to go.
Mm-hmm.
Because even though he can't prevent, there's no way to prevent the trade from happening with the shielded minibot to the juggler. But if both of those went to face, then the shielded minibot would even survive.
Right, definitely. But here, we see that Life Coach actually has an answer next turn with the consecration against this muster.
Yep.
It's gonna be pretty powerful.
It could be.
Still, initiative is still on Chalky's side, right? Because after Consecration, it's still Chalky's first turn to play a minion.
Chalky is curving out really, really nicely here too. That Shredder, it can be a problem if you draw it later on because of them. Well, not really a problem, but if you like draw multiple of those or turn 4 is when you want to play it.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mess up the Divine Favors that way. There's no Divine Favor yet, so it is possible that Chalky would run out of gas, but I... Just seem a little bit ahead now. It's interesting. I don't know, the Belcher is going to be painful to deal with.
Oh wow.
Ooh, that's gonna help with the Belcher. That's really, really good.
The Belcher is the Argus
right now.
It's actually
that's
insane.
Looking at the perfect way for Chalky to get through it.
Exactly. I wonder how much this matchup depends on the Joust actually winning from Tuskar Jouster.
Because
at some point, Life Coach has to stabilize, right? There's Equality, there's Muster. I guess Chalky... Equality is not terrific against Chalky's minions anyways, but still an option. We'll have to see. But the Argus is definitely like huge.
If Life Coach knew that there is a bit... like a defender of Argus coming, he probably would have went with a different line of play, but in this situation, how do you predict that? I don't think you can.
Especially since you actually, I don't think Chalky has ever run defender of Argus in his decks, in his Aggro Paladin decks.
I can't remember seeing that from Chalky. Oh, well, Life Coach looking for the second consecration.
What?
What?
That's surprising.
I guess you run that over Zombie Chow, right? So, are you really that confident in winning a Joust to actually have a 50-50 roll on the stat line just so your opponent can't heal for, you know?
I wouldn't be, but apparently Life Coach is. Because that's also like, it kind of, well, sort of Zombie Joust. I was going to say that it ruins the Joust for the other Joust cards, like the Tuskar. But, so does the Zombie Chow.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see.
Kill to side. That's actually pretty funny how it's actually revealed. And let's do it again in the back.
Win the jumps.
No.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, that was the better way around for Life Coach, for sure.
That's
like, true. He had only one jumps there. That's how he wanted it to be.
Right. Well, back over to Chalky here.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty good trade with the 5-1, but he knows that Life Coach doesn't really have a way to deal with that, so maybe only clear that 1-2. I don't think you play around the second consecration, you know that it's not in there, and Life Coach shouldn't draw any additional cards.
Exactly. Sometimes you just have to hit the face.
Yep.
That's one way to win, right? You hit your opponent down to your play.
So much damage. The Joust not too helpful in the end. If he lost the Joust, he would be down to 3 and 0 chance to win. Oh, that had to be the consecration.
Yeah, way too heavy. So like we predicted, right? Life Coach is running more of a control paladin, and Chalky's aggression is gonna take the game.
Unless Shredder things happen. I think the Shredder is Life Coach's only chance now.
Shredder things, okay. Yeah, there's always a non-0% chance that actually helps you out, so you might as well just have a look at what it is, and then just, you know, go from there.
Aside from that, I don't see a way to survive. There's nothing. There's nothing
in it. No, not in this current predicament. Definitely not.
I think it even has to be exactly Doomsayer. If it's an explosive ship, it's going to be protected behind the 2-1 squire.
Oh yeah, that's true. Okay. Not even like... Unstable Ghoul.
Unstable Ghoul. I guess he can Equality and hit it with the Master. Nope. That's not it. And that's game.
Alright. Well, aggro does beat control, and Chalky is going to take a second win for Forcing Boars.
Just like that. Oh, pretty sweet hand. A little bit slow from Life Coach. He did find the shielded mini, but I think the game would have been over on like turn 4 if he never got the mini. But yeah. Seems like a good matchup. There's some new things maybe that could be like they are added, especially the slower paladin. But in general, I think that matchup favors the fast one quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's just like seeing those, seeing the Gelders are too. I mean, the Divine Favors were there for Chucky, and he could have drawn those. There's no way for the slow Paladin to dump the entire hand fast enough. So Divine Favors guaranteed to draw.
Yeah, but and then again, we have to account for the fact that Chucky got a really good matchup there. If you just look at all the, I think every other matchup that Aggro Paladin would have been unfavored against, the Patron Warrior, the Druid, the, probably Freeze Mage, and the Hunter, of course.
Yeah, definitely one of the better ones. So that's one for Simbus right there. I don't think there was any like mind games really. It's so early on, and so many decks are still open. So it was just a bit of luck. And yeah, just like that. 2-1, Forcing Boys. So what to go with next? Are there still so many decks open that there's no real mind games going into it? Or is it because of... Is there... Like, do the mind games start here? Lifeghost lost the previous game, so do you predict that it will be somebody else playing? Does it affect the decision on what deck to go
for? Yeah, the bench system does affect it, but I guess early on, there's just so many permutations you can do with all the matches, right? Six decks for six decks. So yeah. A good strategy would just be go with the strongest deck. And not only can you just win games and gain momentum, you actually have like a clear picture on what the matchups in the future are going to look like. And you can like plan a little bit better. Also, you dodge the bench rule, right, by winning. So winning is good. Winning is a good strategy.
Yeah, I like winning. Yeah, that's pretty good. So do you go with like a patrons from four simple then? I guess
I guess you can. And once again, you also have like the three-man strategy, right? Where you want to keep all three players in as long as possible and not have one person advance through so that your opponent can choose a good matchup. We saw the Temple Storm kind of struggled in the middle when Hyped already was the first one to just go 2-0. But so
it's the offense rule, yeah. So it could be that if Forsen boys go for the same thing, that they would have Forsen play either the Mage or the Warlock now.
Yeah, it seems like Freeze Mage is a very valid choice. It does have overall very strong matchups. And if Nihilim actually, predicts that, then they will have to go with, like, say, the Warrior, perhaps?
Or Druid. Druid could be safe from Forsen, from Nihilim.
Yeah,
Druid. What's the worst thing that can happen if they go Druid?
Druid is there's always like the dream with like ramp and whatnot, so there's always good matchups. And there's also Hunter, right? Monk said, Druid is favorite is against Hunter.
Well, it's amazing how good Druid is based on the statistics. I don't feel like it's that amazing, but I suppose it's just some of the losses are so memorable. Like when you don't draw the Wildcrow, it's just of the losses with Druid are so one-sided that it feels like it's losing more games than it actually is.
Not only that, but you have to consider that most people consider Druid to be one of the easier decks to pilot. So it could be possible that Druid players are just making fewer mistakes in tournaments.
Yeah, that's possible. That is true. Like, Druid, personally, I think... I don't know, it's really impossible to say what is the easiest deck to play. But Druid seems to be one of the most like straightforward decks, and you look at how much mana you have and you make the most powerful play with the amount of mana that you have. You can see that applies to a lot of decks, but some of the decks have more options where they utilize all of their mana, like different paths, different routes on how to do it, but Druid kind of just has a lot of minions. So.
Yeah, I mean, we also kind of predicted this kind of matchup, right? Where it's going to be like, Freeze Mage when Forsen goes.
Wow! That's actually pretty funny. Like, we predicted it, like Freeze would make sense for Forsen boys, and then like Druid. The safe pick. They went exactly for that.
Yeah. Cool. Well, Forsen has a pretty good starting hand, contrary to the previous weeks where he would actually start up all the secrets in his hand. Mm-hmm. And then, all the burn, all the AoEs in the Freeze Mage Mirror. It might happen. It might happen again. You see the ice block.
And there's the turn to Hero Power. I don't think that Forsen's hand is that amazing, but it definitely could be a lot worse.
I just did a little bit of mind games there.
Mm-hmm. Like maybe trying to bluff that he has access to inner raid or something.
Yep. Something like that probably.
There's always a wild death growth would have happened, so you can't bluff a wild growth.
Yeah, sure, why not? I mean
the next level plays, not fast. Save it for later on.
Cause you have an option to bluff So why not take it anyways, I guess?
Yeah, you can draw a card with Wildcard on turn 10. If you don't cast it on turn 2, that's pretty good. You can cycle it. With Chromacus, you can draw like a lot of cards.
Oh wow, Force is actually going to establish his second Acolyte.
Yeah.
Now, I know in general you want to silence off, like, you want to save your keepers for the Doomsayers, but you just have these, like, two really juicy Acolytes on the board. Do they deserve a silence?
It seems like silence can also work in a way with when you're playing place, like, freezes your board. It actually acts as, like, a surprise lethal. Not to also mention that Keeper can sometimes just ping the face and go through Ice Barrier, right? Usually, you know, two Ice Blocks are over.
Right.
And then they have an Ice Barrier up and you have nothing else to do and Keeper actually accomplishes that. But it feels like Taish feels like, you know, card draw is just too important for the Freeze Mage and just gonna silence that off.
Yeah, because that's silence right there. It doesn't prevent just one draw, it prevents two. Because turn four, it's kind of guaranteed that the thing would have happened on that if he didn't go for it. So it makes sense. It feels bad because now you know that if the Doomsayer Nova goes off, there's probably nothing you can do to stop it. But still very good. That Emperor coming next, but right now, Druid of the Claw, you're gonna be mana efficient.
And yep, going straight to the face, I guess, would be nice. You are racing a Freeze Mage, you do not want to give them a lot of time to develop their card draw.
Right.
Man, at this point, imagine how sick a Frost of a Doomsayer would be after you've seen the Keeper of the Grove come down.
Sure.
I feel like in this particular matchup, it's all, like 70% of it is about whether a Doomsayer does get off. Like, if it does get off, the Freeze player's chances of winning the game just skyrocket immensely.
I agree. But Thais does have the Wrath swipe, so that is 7 damage. So there is that optional way to deal with it. It doesn't feel good to use two cards like that. And now he even drew the second Keeper, by the way.
Yeah, that's perfect. And Forsen is not looking in the... Like, he's in a good spot. Force the Ice Lance, the Emperor to kill it, and that's a little bit of burn lost.
Yeah, it doesn't feel great, but at least he had a way to deal with it, and it didn't need to like use two Frost Bolts or anything like that.
Yeah, to be fair though, I feel like the Freeze Mage player looks like he's always losing this matchup, and then all of a sudden sometimes like they just like Alexstrasza burn to face, and they're like, oh, I just won all of a sudden.
That's true. Oh, not placing the Shredder in the middle.
We'll see if it gets punished by that.
Yeah, it should be like every time you don't place in the middle, it should spawn either a Flame Tongue or Direwolf Alpha, if you ask me.
I actually casted a game recently where a player missed lethal because his Shredder spawned. He placed his Shredder on the incorrect side of his other minion, and it spawned a Direwolf Alpha, and he tried to Force of Nature, but then like the trees appeared on the wrong side.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay, so middle and then right and then left, right?
Yeah.
So that's the priority. Well, Vital Tissue is an interesting tech.
Yeah, it is. I wonder if there's other deck cards in there, like Power of the Wild then. Because if you run Vital Tissue, Power of the Wild suddenly becomes kind of good.
Right. I mean, is it Couture Drop?
I am ready. Yes.
If you don't have minions. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, here's a board full of stuff. And Forsen doesn't really have a way to kill the stuff.
No, not at all.
Yeah, it's really interesting how everyone is bringing different 4-drops into this new type of druid, but everyone agrees that you need like around four 4-drops.
Okay. Oh, with the Keeper, that's 6, right?
Well, 6, yes. Yeah. Or like the 4 solid 4-drops that you just want to throw on the board immediately.
Yeah, exactly.
Like you have the Amnesiac... Chewin Yeti, you have Thais bringing Violet Teacher, and you have Hyped bringing Savage Combatant.
I think it's
the reason mostly because of the Darnassus Aspirant, because you get to more easily ramp from 2 mana to 4 mana. It used to be just the Shredders and Keepers, but now it's like, okay, there's more ways to go straight to 4, so yeah. By the way, getting a Loot Hoarder, not too bad. Definitely one of the better ones. So you silence the Loot Hoarder, go face for 2, no?
whoa.
Wow, the plays.
That's a double draw.
I like it a lot. Wow, it's a really good play.
Pretty good. I didn't even see that. I think that's pretty smart. Trying to find a big minion to play. No need to find the Shredder. Shredder is the biggest, but the best they can do. At least something gets left behind from that.
Mm-hmm.
Like even if it's a game strike, that is.
Exactly. Oh. Far right.
So, do you Alex Strauss now? Go for the top X.
I guess you have to, right? I mean, at this position, you just kind of have to do it. Yeah.
This is looking exactly like Monk was describing how the matchup can go sometimes. Like, Freeze Mage looks like it's not doing well at all, and then boom, Alex Strauss.
Yeah, but is it actually that good? What Taish can do is actually sacrifice a creature, play Ancient of Lore, and just armor up every single turn and get out of that range of a burst. Your opponent is only holding 5 cards, you know. And also, if like Forza already used an Ice Lance, there's not going to be that much burst coming in.
No, there might be a Pyre in there, so that would help. And with the Ice Block, the first Ice Block is not even getting triggered right now. And then with another one in hand, there might be enough time to like pick up their pieces. It seems a little bit like he's going to need the Pyre. Like, without the Pyre, it's going to be hard.
Mm-hmm.
Going up to 24. Wow. And if he gets Antoniras, it's only going to be one fireball extra.
Yeah, so it's not going to be that good. Oh wow, Tesh actually feels like he should develop. Counting up lethal damage, of course, and it feels like that Shade is important to pop the block.
Ooh,
and no. The punish.
Well, but we can't blame Tice for this. Tice kind of knew that it's unlikely there to be a Flamestrike because the previous turn was so good for Flamestrike already and it didn't happen. So I would have also just played that out.
Right.
But yeah, punish is happening right here.
It's forcing thinking of something a bit more creative though.
No way.
He's probably just thinking about what to ping.
True.
Either the 5/5 or the 3/5.
Mm. Well, ping the explosive chip. Ping the explosive chip. Ooh. Interesting shredders this game. First one the Lord's Horror, that one now. Ruby and Egg. That's kind of a tough call here. What do you think? You don't want to. Unfortunately, doesn't have any more AoE, so the 1/1s are scary. Because there might be a roar coming.
Yeah, it's actually very sick that Wild Grove actually summons 2 1/1s.
Yeah.
Ooh, Dr. Broom.
That's pretty good. Just do that. EP Rope Arm, I guess.
Yep. Tash already missed the Hero Power last turn.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, Forza needs some help. Oh, that's burned, but
okay.
It is so high right now.
So how much is that now if he gets the last Ice Lance? He used one Ice Lance on the Emperor Torison, so he only has one remaining. But if he was to pick it up, it would be 23. No, it's not enough.
Hmm. Well, I mean, whatever. Just gonna drop and heal.
Yeah.
If he actually just Frostbolt, Fireball, that puts him. That puts his opponent in range for the Pyro Blast the next turn.
Yeah. But the thing is, like, if you have an Ice Block in play, and you have another Ice Block that you're going to play soon, usually you just want to, like, spam the ping as much. So Fireball, ping would have been the better play than Frostbolt, because otherwise you're going to lose 1 damage and never ever take that back.
Right. Okay, checking the Boom Bot first.
Mm-hmm.
Hoping to roll high on something.
No, ooh. That's the maximum on the wrong thing.
Yeah. Two of it getting kind of wasted. That's okay. Let's see what he picks up. Azure Drake. Huh.
Not bad.
Yeah, he's trying to draw for, I believe, Lotep Aura. Well, that's useless. Lotep Aura or the last Roar.
Or Roar would be nice too.
Oh yeah, Roar. Yeah.
A lot of solid cards overall.
No, Roar would have been nice earlier, it would let him like pop the block, but I think now it's like... Well, it does still help, like if the entire board gets frozen, then he can still pop with the combo from hand. There's the ice lands, but it's simply not enough burn.
And of course, it is your last freeze that Frostbolt, so you have to use Frostbolt with the ice lands.
Yeah. So how about like Fireball Frostbolt ice lands? Then if you get an Antonidas, you can go Antonidas ice block. Then you have double fireballs. Would that be enough? It would be if there's no heal.
Yeah, that seems okay.
What about Arcane Intellect? Just Antonidas. Wow, it actually would have been the next card to draw.
So wait, we can't even Antonidas and Frostbolt ice lands next turn.
It doesn't work anymore.
Well, most likely he'll Archmage Antonidas and then ice block.
Yeah, he has to ice block.
And then the problem with that is he'll only have 15 damage on the very next turn.
Yeah, if he went for the other player, like without the Arcane Intellect, he would have actually drawn the exact cards that he needed. Like the play that I was first like suggesting, but how do you know that the Archmage is the very next card? Like you can't know it. It's like the only scenario where it would have been strictly there.
Yeah, Forsen has no more Frostbolts or Ice Lances. Those are the only one copies of each. And,
if he has the Pyro, I guess this is like where you just go all in and hope to top deck it. Right?
True, yes. Very true.
Seems like the only potential. But if there's no Pyro, then there's also no hope, I believe.
Okay, I like that play. So yeah, let's just do that.
Just play all the Frostbolts.
Yep. So, yeah, all the left-hand side spells.
Yep. There's no burn left, so like Emperor plays, those don't accomplish anything.
Yeah, there's actually a really good possibility that Forsen doesn't have Pyro in his deck. I know a lot of people have been cutting it just to deal with the number of Patron Warriors on the ladder or in these kind of tournaments, and Pyro isn't really a card that you really want to be using. Most oftentimes, it just deals 10 damage to your opponent's armor, and you'd rather deal with patrons rather than deal damage in that matchup.
Alright, here we go!
I don't see a way to win with this play, but I mean, if he doesn't have the Pyro, I guess that's like... You just hope to get a Frost Nova or something, and then like your opponent not have any damage, but this... I think every single of them, single one of those would pop the block, even through... like everything being frozen. Well, not the roar. All those other four cards. Other five cards would do it. Yeah.
Sure, why not?
Not sure why he casted.
Doomsayer is way too late. So that's it! Forsen's gonna drop this game. I don't see an out.
No, there's no way.
If only Forsen only had one more mana, you know? One more mana would have cut it.
Yeah, it was actually a really close game. And it's kind of indicative of the fact that this matchup is generally closer than most people think. It's actually around like 57%-ish. Whereas I think like most players would give it somewhere around 70%.
Yeah. But the Emperor a tiny bit there. No, making the honorable Subaru here. With the ping boom, but nice job. If he managed to somehow squeeze in the Emperor in early turn, if even one of those spells was discounted, he had the fireball, he had the fireballs, the frostbolt ice, like you were mentioning that it was one mana out from lethal, so no matter how early the Emperor was played, if just like one Frostbolt was discounted, it would have been enough. Emperor Thor is definitely one of the most important cards, if not the most important in that matchup, and he just never had the time to play.
Yeah, I think even though Emperor, it probably helped out Freeze Mage and Druid more than any other deck, I'd have to say it helped Freeze Mage slightly more, especially in like the Freeze Mage versus Druid matchup.
Yeah.
Yep, very true. Yep, heading back to the head-to-head screen here. 2-2. This is actually going to be very close, and I assume this is going to be very, very close as well. I mean, it is phase two after all. We have the top six in a sense. And then I can only imagine how, you know, what kind of play we're going to see in the finale. Yeah, the finale is obviously going to be in September 11th to 13th. And players are going to have much more time to kind of like feel out the meta, feel out what decks are good, what cards are good. And it's going to be even more insane there. This is just like a taste of what's about to happen, you know?
Yeah, pretty awesome. Right now, some of the players might have been, because there's so much on the line and so little time to prepare the deck. Some of these players might be a little bit scared to be bringing out completely new strategy. And we've seen it that most of the decks have been more or less like the same old stuff. Just a couple of added cards added in. The one deck that we have seen completely new so far was the reason why Team Archon lost the first match of the day.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that Eloise's deck was pretty much completely new. It was like, it had a zoo base, but I felt like it only had around like 10 of the normal zoo cards.
Alright, fair enough. There was actually a lot in there. And Gar was playing some of the new cards. Yeah, the priest. The dragon priest, I guess.
Oh, dragon priest, of course.
Yeah.
So there has been some innovations, but still, like, most of the decks have been old stuff.
Right.
Yeah. It's just, like, some of these decks are just so tried and true that you just have to stick to them, and you can make small improvements to decks like the Druid. And I think, like, even though TGT has only been out for 2 days-ish, I think the improvements made to Druid will stick. Like, the Aspirants and the Roots are probably, like, gonna still be in Druid 1 month down the line.
I think so. At least the Roots. I like the Roots a lot. The Aspirant, it's really good when you get in early time, but it's so bad later on. So I've been thinking about it. If maybe running just one to make it less likely. So you have like just enough. Because if you end up with Wildcrow and an Aspirant for them too, you can't really cast both of them. So it's just one Aspirant maybe the number to play. Because I think that the Wildcrow is still the better card. But it's a good, like, Aspirant is still a good card, that's for sure.
Alright, next up is going to be Forsen again on Freeze Mage. You can play against the Life Coach, you know, control paladin-ish, mid-range. We know that Life Coach is playing a slow paladin. And once again, the bench rule is in play. Forsen, if he loses this game, he will be benched and not be able to queue any more games until one of his teammates wins one.
Yeah, Forsen was getting the edge here with the matchup, some good mind games from them. Nihilum probably not expecting to see the freeze mages right after. Forsen was risking the bench by Forsen with having him play again, but it has resulted in Forsen was getting a very favorable matchup. This is one of the better ones when you're playing freeze. Just the way that the paladin has to get a strong board going in order to deal damage. And the amount of AoE in the freeze mage, it's really good for the mage.
Yeah, with Kel'Thuzad in a paladin list, it seems like
you
know, Life Coach is really looking to get the value game and, like, you know, seal your opponent's mid-range deck out. We know that, you know, on a big board, and if Life Coach actually just, like, trades for stuff and then plays KT, the game is just over, right?
In this matchup, it seems worthless.
Yeah, like, it does.
Absolutely worthless. It was just much rather have something like a Ragnaros.
Mm. Well, this is a very good stuff for Life Coach. I mean, it's a 2-drop into a 2-drop. You actually have something to play. Usually, Paladin skip the turn 1, and that's actually not enough pressure. So,
yeah,
very good.
It seems like a decent start. I think he knows that he needs to kind of end this game quickly. And with the double minibots, even though we might see some rope action here, I'm like 99% sure that we're going to see the minibot come out.
Indeed. Oh, Life Coach just doing Life Coach things. Kind of think of all the possibilities and, of course, future possibilities.
Yeah. I mean, he could coin out the equality, but that's not very good.
You don't think?
No.
I think you could actually, you could actually play. Oh, wow. Okay.
Wow, no mini, but. I mean, if he only had one. Then I would never like coin out, but with two, I would lean towards coining it. Interesting.
Wow, look at this. This could have been so good. He could have turn 3 Aldo Peacekeeper and then turn 4 Shredder. I feel like you really want to drop Aldo as like a 3-3 in this matchup and just like go phase.
That tripped mini, but.
Mhm.
It's like forcing ahead on tempo right now. Interestingly enough.
bear is gonna come out. We do see the Tuskar Jouster in hand.
I'm gonna be really curious as to the timing of when Life Coach is gonna use that Jouster, because we saw Eloise kind of hold back on the Jouster on her turn 5, and it turned out eventually that she was missing 2 extra damage to kill off Firebat. So it might just be correct to just play it on curve and get out the most damage possible.
Yeah, at the same time, it's kind of like the healing, right? I mean, if you're counting your healing cards, maybe you're just running, like, you're cutting heal buff for it, and suddenly you cannot win after your opponent Alexstrasza ice block you, and then follows with another ice block, for example. That's even worse. So, yeah, it's interesting.
Wow. Life got really, like, living up to his reputation here.
Well, right now it seems like Forsen and Life Coach hasn't got a game so far, right? So I guess the kind of stress is kind of on the line.
Forsen on the other hand, he's like playing super fast. His turns is like boom boom, but I mean he has a lot of time between during Life Coach's turns to consider all the options, I guess.
Yeah, we also saw Life Coach. He struggled a bit against Liquid last week, in which he made a few mistakes during his game and almost cost his team the championship or the playoff position.
Yep. It was really close too, right? Oh man, it was so brutal to watch, especially if you're a teammate of Life Coaches. You guys, like, both RD and Taish got 2-0, and then Life Coach just caught dropping game after game. It was kind of brutal.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, if you're gonna put your hopes in anyone, it might as well be like a player of Life Coach's caliber.
Mm-hmm. Still, things sometimes don't go your way, and it could be very stressful. Forsen is actually doing a very good job of keeping his high life total very high and drawing a lot of cards, while maintaining a little bit of a board control here.
The double ice block's not fantastic, but this life total, it should have a lot of time. There's no good way for Life Coach to deal with the Doomsayer right now either. Life Coach does have the equality, so there is he can kill it eventually with equality through silver. So it's like one of those moments, like in some classes, like Priest, if they don't have Shadow of Pain and Paladin, sometimes it's just impossible to deal with the Doomsayer. Once the Doomsayer goes off, it's very 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 good situation for them, for the mage player. All right.
Well, not much to do here, to be honest.
I don't know.
You don't want to use your burn ever. So, like, even though fireballing the Belcher and then pumping it in would be kind of good value, you don't want to do that. So it's probably just like a passage turn. So, like, just set up a secret, ping your acolyte, and you're not gonna overdraw no matter what.
That's true. I like it. Yep.
Is there a reason not to ping first, though?
Well, I guess it should ping first in case you get, like, barrier, so you can play barrier first.
Aren't both barriers out already? Or is that just one?
I feel like that was just one. I'm not sure.
It's interesting. I find it interesting that he's not trying to maximize the card, so...
Maybe he feels like there's enough pressure on the board that he can't really get the both acolytes out really efficiently.
Guess.
If your opponent does hit an acolyte, it's kind of like a heal for 3 and draw a card.
It's true. Kind of.
Yeah. So that's kind of worth 3 life. I guess that's why acolyte is in this deck in the first place. It's just it demands removal.
Yeah, but he did get more card draw. With the token in, like, it seems to have really paid off. But in case that he didn't, like, find the cards just yet. It would have at least been an option to try and play one acolyte first, squeeze in all the cards you can from it, then squeeze in the maximum cards from the second one afterwards.
That's a really interesting play. He equips the True Silver, and he just wants to use it for healing, essentially.
Yeah. Has he given up on trying to kill the mage and trying to just maybe out-heal the damage? I'm not sure.
Yeah, you do have two swords. Feels like you kind of want to put in the damage, but at the same time, if you don't follow through, then the heal will be wasted. And yeah, it's actually a twofold card where you not only deal 4 damage, but you heal 2 life.
On the other hand, it has the second true silver too. It has 2 true silvers. Do you really need to save the Chargers?
This has been just a really slow game. Not just because Life Coach is playing, but because both players have been playing like pretty defensively here.
Yep.
You can see like, as the Freeze Mage player on turn 7, you're still at 28 health.
I mean, they're both pretty defensive decks, right? Until that one burst turn. For Paladin, it's not that one burst turn. It's the value game where, you know, you trade minions with your True Silvers, you get them back with KT. So, different game plan. So, the one that actually wants to burst your opponent has a slight advantage.
Yeah. Life goes with the True Silver, with the Tuskar Joust around the lay on hands. That could be a 15 healing in his hand, potentially. He has to win the Joust. But that's after Alex Straza is gone, I guess he might be favored to do so. There's still things that ruin it. Like the Joust from the Tuskar is not reliable at all when you have those shielded minipots, for example, in the deck.
To be honest, I think it's actually quite reliable after your opponent uses Alex Straza, right? Because like their big guy is gone. And then Antonetus might probably be in the hand, and then you're facing like what, Emperor for 6? And then everything else you can sort of beat. Now, one of the problems Life Coach is running into is that he does run the Gadgetzan Jouster, and that is a 1-drop. And when that's you just have 1-drop, you pretty much lose with everything, unless your opponent has no more minions in the deck.
He probably has like a second, well he does, he played better to see the minions, but there should be like a second juggler in there. He's favored for sure when the joust happens, but it's not still like a 100% win.
There's also the possibility that the Alex Straza and the Emperor are like the last two cards remaining in the Freeze Mage's deck, and if that happens, there's a possibility that that Force will, or that Life Coach will just be able to like heal out the damage out of the way.
Right. The end might be coming. Life Coach can deal with it with equality.
Oh! Does that help?
No.
No? Yeah, no. Actually. Oops.
It almost helps. I mean, if you had like one more mana, you could equality coin and then Kel'Thuzad. And that like kind of saves your board against any type of clear. I actually was wondering, like, when he's been keeping this coin for so long, is it because he wants to go into like turn 7 Tyrion, for example?
I'm not really sure. I think it's just like a bad bad decision not to coin out a mini bot in turn 1 because he had Life Coach has such a good curve.
It would have been like the game would look completely different if he did go with that. It would have been completely different. There were, at all times, I think there would be one minion from the Paladin side of the board going phase, which would have added up to a lot of damage over the 8 turns. Wow, not using the equality, just letting the Doomsayer happen. I mean, I guess it doesn't kill all that much.
And again, he's just being as defensively as as defensively as possible.
Yep.
It's like kind of working out since Orson, he has like, yeah, he has like all these cards, but he can't actually use any of them that effectively. And
his hand is full right now, so he needs to throw something away. I don't even play like the heal, but it gets almost wasted. Do you throw away the blizzard? That doesn't feel good either.
Maybe you could.
I guess it's the blizzard. Yeah.
Yeah, you saw your Doomsayer just went off, so it's likely if you have a second Doomsayer and if you have the Frost Nova combo with it, if you use it again, more likely than not, it will probably go off the second time.
Mm-hmm. I like this. He's setting up for the Antonidas here. That has to be the plan. He wants the Life Coach not to play anything, so he can play the Antonidas Frostbolt Islands on an empty board, but it's not going to work out. I think we are going to see an equality. See, he still has the Alder Peacekeeper for potential Alex Straza. That's the last Doomsayer. Like, it's such a tempo. If you equal it and kill it off, it lets you play the Emperor, which is so powerful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can even consider, say, knife juggling and coining the Emperor instead, and just save the sword from like being used.
Oh yeah, that's true. But I mean, he might not hit the knife, but he can always try. Maybe you don't need the coin anymore.
Whoa.
What?
Wow.
Oh man, so he's just taking the discount so that he would die.
I will throw that off, and it's really weird.
That's interesting.
It's weird because it's like if he hadn't done that, the Emperor would still be alive and Forsen would have to spend some amount of like energy to clear it off. It's like tanking damage as well.
I don't think that worked out very well for Life Gods there.
No, well, not at all. I mean, look at Forsen's hand. It's going to be insane next turn. He can, Forsen can actually draw 4 fireballs. So the Tuskar Jester is just going to like heal for 1 fireball. A little bit too crazy there. The Emperor top deck was definitely what Forsen looked for.
4 fireballs for Forsen potentially. Oh my goodness. That's incredible.
Yeah, not only that, but it'll take quite a bit of work to clear off this Emperor.
Yeah. He needs to juggle it, then he can use the weapon.
Alright, Garrison Jouster, what's it gonna be? Alright, that's a win.
Oh, so he runs a Jouster and a Gilbot.
No way.
Yeah.
Oh man, if he doesn't hit the juggle, this is so bad. He has to hit the juggle.
Okay.
Oh, he gets it. That was very important. He probably would have went with something like a coin hero power if he didn't hit that and try it one more time. Obviously you can't leave that up, so yeah.
Yeah.
Forsen must feel slightly bad that he lost that joust, because he only has about 3 minions left in his deck.
Yeah.
And one of them is Alexstrasza.
Alexstrasza. Alexstrasza and
it's Alexstrasza, Scientist Hoarder.
Sounds about right, yeah.
But here's the good part. Like, if right now, I think if Forsen draws the Mad Scientist, he'll win like pretty much every joust. What
to do? Yeah, you can see that. But yeah, I think it's definitely gonna go first here. I mean, I really don't see why. You just throw 4 fireballs, and it's just too many.
5 fireballs.
Wait, 1, 2. Oh, yeah, 5 with the coin. Yeah. Makes sense.
Oh. Aha.
Okay, I think it's time to start healing.
Yeah, this is the joust that really matters, not the previous one.
But you also need to kill the Antonitis, so. Whoa, Consecrate is a good draw. You don't need to take further. It actually cannot actually attack anything, right? So. Yeah.
You can try with Alder first. Hold on. Like Alder, Tuskar, Consecration. He needs to hit 1 knife. Or he can just go for the equality if he wants to be completely safe.
No, I'll play a turtle here.
Alright. Here you go. This joust, it's absolutely huge. I think Forsen is still ahead, even if Life Coach wins the battle.
Oh!
And that's
brutal, brutal.
Yeah.
Forsen is pretty happy about that.
Oh yeah, that was such a huge deal.
So this is actually the worst case scenario for Life Coach, because he's gone down to below 14, but Forsen still had the Alexstrasza in his deck. So he's gonna guaranteed to win jousts.
Not drawing the Alexstrasza kind of paid off, I guess.
Wow. If you want to buy more time, Forsen, you can.
Nah, I think it's just like. He could ping phase, like Flamestrike and ping phase. No, but then the True Silver.
You kill the Troll card. This card, yeah.
Yeah, then the True Silver would do it. Maybe like double fireball and just being the KT, or okay. You could wait for the Alexstrasza.
Yeah, I like this. Because like, if your opponent is scared of using any form of heal now, right? And you also threaten with Frostbolt, like as soon as you draw Frostbolt, the game is over. Actually not. Yeah, there's the sword hit, right? So.
Oh, there's the signature life coach piloted Sky Golem.
He does like that card a lot.
Yeah, so out of all the pros, he's like the only player who uses that card. And he even used it in Druid for a while.
Yeah, I used for a little while, but not for that long. I played it in like a couple of tournaments, but that's it. Do you play it right now? I mean, you saw that you were not dead at 14. You can heal back to 16. He also, Life Coach knows that there's still the Alexstrasza in the deck, so is healing right now a bad idea?
What's the deck card? So we have 4 cards for Forsen left, and then we have 14 cards for Life Coach. It's gonna go with heal. Alexstrasza's not a deck, and just go like, oh, heal bot as well. This is kind of like a medic shaman. A medic paladin. That's what I meant.
Mm-hmm.
So let's play some tempo cards here. Knife Juggler, Coin, Hero Power?
It could. You could also save the coin for something else right now.
What?
Jesus.
Oh man.
Yep. It's important to fire off the fireballs that you created.
Yep.
Playing Lay on Hands was pretty huge actually for Life, because he knew better his deck better than I know his deck. There was the heal bot that he needed to. I'm sure that that's like the main reason why he Lay on Hands. He knows that he has more healing.
See, the problem right now is that Forsen is still at 30 health. Although Forsen is at like 3 cards, Life Coach has to just look to heal out through all the rest of the bird, plus race kind of like the rest of time, right?
What do you guys think of not attacking with the True Silver last turn? Is he gonna heal for 2 extra? And he has the second one in his hand. Is he gonna get to use all the charges now?
Well, he can always just use it now. And actually, he'll about establish the War Golem or Sky Golem.
Right.
It's fine.
Yeah, I feel like if you don't play the golem here, like, you're never going to be able to kill your opponent. So, no, I think... I think
those icebox are never getting triggered, that's for sure.
I do like the attack.
If Life Coach is to win this, it has to be with the fatigue, right?
Yep. Oh, wow. Even more burn.
Yeah. Life Coach now out of heals. He needs to, like, have another Lay on Hands or no, it's not even enough. He would actually it is enough because he can't True Silver. He can't heal with True Silver.
Oh yeah, but that card does not do it.
Yeah, that's game.
Well, he cannot True Silver because he's frozen.
Yeah, exactly. So even if he picked up something like the second heal bot, he would only went up to 12, which would have meant that he would still die to a double fireball.
Mm-hmm. Put your faith in the
light. Not good enough.
Furion Fortress slams on the table. I'm almost
out of cards. Yeah, I feel like this game came back to that turn where Life Coach decided to just take the discount of the Thorzin and didn't clear off the Doomsayer of his opponents.
Oh, that was so funny. Yeah.
it just allowed his opponent to get the Emperor off for free, essentially. And it gave his opponent 5 fireballs. When you're a deck that is relying on healing to combat Freeze Mage, I don't think that's just really viable at all. Letting him get those 5 fireballs so easily.
Yeah, it's not. That's so hilarious. Like, the last card in Forsen's deck was the Alexstrasza, and it still won him the game because of the joust.
Yeah, Alexstrasza just wins even if you don't play her. That's interesting.
That's neat.
Yeah.
Usually you would see Forsen like just really complaining about how like Alexstrasza was my last card, but in this scenario, because of the introduction of the new mechanic of joust, like things worked out, I guess. So sometimes being unlucky is actually lucky.
Yeah.
Wow.
Just leaving Alexstrasza in the deck to counter joust, I guess. Something you can do. Forsen Boys is gonna go up in one game, 3-2. And Forsen is gonna pick up his first win, so it's Life Coach have yet to win a game. But hey, we are pretty much in the middle of the series. We'll have to see who is going to be up next to the fighting arena, I guess.
Oh yeah, could be anyone. No, it's will Nihilum now risk Life Coach getting benched? Will Forsen Boys predict that they're gonna Like, not pick life coach. This is where the mind games happen. I think the bench rule is really cool.
Yeah, I think the bench rule just really favors foursome boys at the moment, because they each have one win with each of their players, so it's kind of hard for them to get benched. They would have to queue the same deck over and over again. Whereas, like, life coach, as you mentioned, life coach is in a bit of trouble. And if you don't want him to get benched, you have to send either RDU or Tice. Just going by the remaining decks, I have to say that, like, even though it's 3 versus 4, I would agree that Forsen boys has the advantage in terms of the decks that they brought. The Paladin does seem to be, like, the weak link at the moment.
Might be. I'm not sure where exactly it should get its win. Ostgaka is likely to be playing Patrons, and that Paladin, I think it's not fast enough to beat Patrons before the combo happens.
Yeah, Ostgaka has been playing Patron, like, pretty much all the time, every single match of the Archon Team League.
Yeah.
All 7 matches, in fact. But he has been known for playing Control Warrior previously, back before Patron Warrior was a thing. Like, Control Warrior, Midrange Druid, and Freeze Mage, and to some extent Rogue. Those were, like, his core decks. Every player in Hearthstone, for the most part, has, like, 3 or 4 core decks that they always bring, and Ostgaka is very known for just bringing those exact decks.
Right, and Ostgaka also, just 2 days ago, he took rank 1 Legend on NA, I believe, with Patrons. Like, how do you not play it when you're so good with it?
Yeah, not a surprise at all. Like, even with TGT coming out, it's still Patrons that are doing so well, and the anti-fun Patrons are, like, kind of farming all those experimental decks, like the mid-range Paladins, the mid-range Shamans, just really punishing them for trying out new things, I guess.
Yeah. Yes, so many different type of strategies right now, on the ladder especially. Like, you can queue into anything. Some of the stuff works better than the other stuff. Like, yeah, I've seen some really terrible decks, even in Legend. But I mean, I can blame people for trying those out, and I've been experimenting a lot with not so great of a decks.
So it's going to be the good old tried and true Hunter from Chalky. Chalky has been playing Hunter pretty much every single game.
Well, that's Chalky card right there, Warden Infiltrator.
Yeah, so the steps to making a Chalky deck are: you take an existing deck, remove, like, the 2 highest costing cards in that deck, and throw in 2 Worgen Infiltrators.
that's a chalky way, yeah.
It's surprisingly very accurate.
Yeah. Oh, wow. It's actually a big joust right here.
Okay.
Nice. That's a huge deal, because now it can, like, it could kill the Worgen Infiltrator without dying. So it might even force the Chalky to... Oh, okay. Well, that's a good card. That's really, really nice. So that lets the Worgen Infiltrator go face too.
Does it?
I think so, yeah. Because the Paladin will be making the trade anyway, right?
Yeah, but are you scared of the Muster for Battle comeback?
I guess you might be a little bit, but the Muster is still gonna be bad for you. And it's going to be 6 damage, because the master weapon going into that is another 3. So I like going face here.
That's a good
point. The master is going to be a disaster in any case. So he could go for it. He could also go for just, like, Coin Alder, Peacekeeper, and kill it off. That would set him with a fairly nice board, like good minions for the trades.
I think the main thing to in this matchup is that the Paladin needs to kill the Hunter, right? You cannot just, like, just clear the board every single time, because charge minions are gonna start to take place, and then the hero power from the Hunter is gonna take place. So I think no matter what we do here, we just want to coin a quartermaster on Muster. I think that's, like, the best choice.
Okay, so.
Yeah,
Chalky trade maybe, if you value the coin that high.
Yeah, generally I agree, but I feel like with Life Coach's particular deck that has a heal bot and a jouster, that's generally one more heal than most Paladins run. Maybe he feels more comfortable playing the longer game.
Oh man.
Oh, man. And it seems a bit like Butcher style also, to just go for the control game.
Mm-hmm.
For Chucky, not too much to do here.
Yeah, pretty abysmal hand here. Well, you just have to, like, you know, click that hero button. Hero power button, I mean.
Yeah. Go face with the steady shot. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow, just actually clearing the board here. So the Shredder actually, you know, stays alive. I guess that makes sense.
A little bit surprising, but Chucky is way better with that deck than I am, so I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I can't really.
Sometimes trade. Sometimes trade.
Yeah, this deck is called Chucky Hunter for a reason.
Yep.
Yeah, for about a week in the Archon Team League, every single Hunter in the Archon Team League was a Chucky Hunter. The specific variation of Hunter that Chucky was running. Now
yeah,
things have become...
right here. Like, yeah. Does he go for the trades? Because if he did not trade and there was no Unleash, that Quartermaster would have been so incredible.
Oh, wow, that's the first 1-2 minion that costs 2 mana, right? I don't think there's anything else. And that should surprise me a little bit.
Novice Engineer used to be a 1-2 a long time ago.
Mm.
But right now in the game, yeah, that's the only one. So, that was a Shredder nerf then?
Yeah, I mean, you used to have like the good ones, like Totem Golem and Wrathguard that came out, you know?
Mm.
Well, I guess it's like debatable whether Wrathguard is a good one or not.
There's also the Darnassus Aspirant that's not very good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really say that one, like, it's better or worse. Wow, this is looking really good for Life Coach right now. That heal would buy him so much more time. He will get to the lay in hand. Chucky in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, not only that, but Chucky is out of cards, and Hunter doesn't really have any way to draw cards outside of a quick shot, which Chucky has already used.
Yes, he already used one. He might not have another one. If he has another one, he might not draw it.
Hmm, do you think that Brave Archer is actually going to be in this deck?
No.
I don't think so, because Chucky already has 6-1 drops.
Okay.
And 6-1 drops is like the optimal amount that Firebat calculated to put in like these kind of aggressive decks.
Okay.
Right, so he would have to take out like something like Working Infiltrator. But it's pretty sweet with things like Clive Zuga.
So yeah, just looking to maximize damage every turn here. If you play all... Ooh! Whoa!
Well then.
Let's get out of here! That's not gonna work. And alright, well, Life Coach takes a win, and everybody is on one win.
Well, that's interesting, Gons here. Do you think he maybe wanted to keep the traps a secret? Because we didn't see a single trap. And if he played a scientist, then scientists get skilled. Maybe there's some new trap, like Bear's Trap, that he wanted to hide.
Yeah, it's a really good point. I mean, I think in that kind of Hunter, you always play 2 Freezing Traps. But again, Bear Trap makes somewhat of a difference. You also oftentimes play a third trap. But actually, I talked to Chucky once, and he told me in his Hunter decks, he only plays 2 traps ever. So it's likely that he plays like a Snake and a Freezing, for example, or a Freezing and a Bear Trap.
Right. Okay. I think no matter what, I think that was a really good call from Chucky to concede there. Like, there was no way he was winning that game. Absolutely none. No matter what the secrets. And by conceding right now, that trap, if it's something that the Life Coach want, or the Team Nihil won't be expecting, it's possible that they'll end up winning a game just by their surprise factor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, we often sometimes like criticize players for leaving a game too early because they might have a chance, but in this specific scenario, even that you're fighting for your teammates, this is like the best option for the team.
Oh, it's also interesting to point out that Bear Trap actually buffs. Not only is Bear Trap really cool, right? Because like, you know, your opponent can't really hit the face and like race you in a certain tough spot. It actually buffs all the other traps. Snake Trap becomes that much better because, you know, people will be like, yeah, everybody's gonna run Bear Trap, right? I'm just gonna trade some minions off, and then they're actually starting to get 3-1-1s, right? So it's actually very cool. Like, even with Paladins, right? Paladins can have like, Paladin might be a bad example, but like mages, for example, right? You know, effigies released, and then there's like much more complication with, like, you know, stuff. You can actually fake it out to be a mirror entity, and then your opponent can play a smaller minion, whereas they could have played, like, a Drew of the Claw at turn 5.
Yeah,
I think it's a pretty, yeah, I think it's a hilarious combination when you run both snakes and bear trap. It's like your opponent can't go face because it might be a bear, your opponent can't go for minions.
Wow.
Snake, so then you just, like, not attack ever, I guess.
That's really cool. Permanent Frost Nova. I like that. Oh. But we're gonna see a Warrior Mirror here, and I'm expecting both of these to be patrons.
Yes, we already saw Oskaka's Warrior, or we didn't see any Warriors yet.
No, we didn't see any in this series.
Yeah. We haven't seen any, but the prediction is that both of these are gonna be patrons.
Yeah, there you go. Life Coach can still not be a patron.
Yeah, but I think Life Coach is less likely to play Control Warrior than Oskaka is.
Yeah, it's highly unlikely for this to be a Control Warrior. The amount of hours the Life Coach has put into practicing and studying patrons, and now when there's, like, more on the line than ever anywhere before, then why would you switch? Oh! But it could be just tech cards in patrons.
Tech cards of BGH and Brawl?
It's a lot of tech cards.
Does that convince you?
Mind game.
Does that convince you, Samish? Oh, man. Okay, I'm changed for the non-patron warrior here. Okay, 100%.
Wow. I'm glad I didn't place any bets on that deck. But I would have been like, if it would be me playing as Life Coach right now, I would be 100% sure that it's patrons.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
I've only seen Light Coach play Control Warrior once in my life, and that was in the first CN versus EU match, where he only knew how to play mid-range Hunter, and he net decked two decks from two of his friends for mid-range Paladin and Control Warrior, and he, like, played those decks pretty badly, I would say.
Okay.
But he still got, like, second place.
Yeah.
Well, all right. I don't know what type of shots fired that is. It seems like multiple shots there.
If you've never played the deck, you'd obviously play it not optimally, right?
It was long time ago. Yeah.
Yeah, really long time ago. I mean, if we look back at Fight Night, videos, I guess we'll see that we're actually pretty bad at the game back then.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just like pulling up the deck list and stuff, like, completely clueless on how to build things.
I remember Crypt saying that, Tyrion is just too slow a card. I'm going to run Divine Favor instead in a, mid-range Paladin. That was pretty fun.
Wow.
Well, Crypt does have a second place finish at BlizzCon, and he just reached Legend recently, so can't really fault it too much.
That's true. Very impressive.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Skoka's actually going to try and draw some cards here. They're buffing the Frogling so it can actually kill.
It's a really interesting play. I like it.
Very cool.
I mean, it's like the weapon seems so convenient, but I think that was better.
Oh yeah. Man, Varin Wrynn, the king himself, has arrived. Well, not yet, at least.
Not yet, it's arrived to the hand. The army of Stormwind coming on turn 10. Yep.
But this turn...
You know, I don't see too many of this type of warrior too much. Like, it's usually these days, the warriors are all control dragon warriors. And this doesn't seem to be one of those decks because it has Sludge Belchers instead of the Blackwing Corruptors, for example.
Right. So it's a control warrior, but with other cards kind of ticked in, I guess. So far, it's only Varian. Other cards look kind of normal.
Yeah, in this specific scenario, the Blackwing Corruptor would have been far better, I think. Now the Frothing Berserker.
Amazing.
Yeah, now the Frothing Berserker can just go wild.
Yeah, but we do have a BGH to counter that afterwards. But of course, Life Coach is going to take a hit, take a chunk of damage here.
Mm-hmm.
Not too bad.
No, he has a shield, man, and he can heal back up.
Yep. Oskaka here is wondering if he should actually waste a, or quote-unquote waste a Whirlwind just to hit the face for a little bit harder. If the Desperate hits the Belcher and then, the Gnomish trades, the Frothing that cannot go face.
It's like 12 damage or 11. What is it? What is that up to?
What, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 more damage. So like 10 actually.
Yeah.
Oh wow. What's happening here?
Fingers executing, it's so much damage.
Yeah, you have to keep in mind that. Oh, I think at this point Oskaka knows that this is probably Control Warrior. Life Coach has teched in BGH and Brawl before. I think in the WCA qualifiers, he teched in both in the same patron deck, but he's never like teched in like a Sludge Belcher in Patron Warrior, for example.
Okay. Well, this is very, very juicy BGH.
Yep.
Very sick.
Yeah, it gets a little bit of a bad trade with the 2-1 Gnomish Inventor, but still alright.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Battle Rage. Cool.
Yeah, 2 mana draw 2 is pretty nice.
Yeah, and not even an overload.
Oh.
Wow.
Is it as if a certain Shaman card is not a good card?
Mm-hmm.
You know what's funny is that Varian could actually be pretty bad in this matchup if it summons like 3 useless minions that don't have taunt or anything.
And like Cruel Taskmaster.
Yeah.
Alright.
But you might also get Ragnaros and Chromash and...
No. That's true.
But definitely, like, if there's a lot of minions coming out of it, even if they're big minions, those draw things get crazy because the whirlwind effects are hitting so many targets.
Yeah, I find it actually kind of funny how the armies of Stormwind consist of like, you know, Taskmaster, you know, Frogman Berserker, and maybe sometimes even Corcoran Elite. They're just all orcs.
Yeah. Wow. Interesting.
Not sure I see the play. Oh, he's gonna pass?
That's... I'm a little confused by this. I'm sure he has a plan.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's time for Life Coach here. We have a big minion every single turn now. Look at the crowd.
Yep. Wow, turn 9, Varian Rune.
Yeah, not only that, but it feels like this Emperor has to be dealt with to a certain extent.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how did you do that?
Execute or Whirlwind. Probably an execute because he has 2. But now we... Oskaga probably hasn't figured out that it's a Control Warrior. Just from the belt. But other than that, it's been like all normal cards.
My real question is, why didn't Oskaga equip the Death Spite in the last turn?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's true. He could have done that. Well, are you scared of Harrison maybe? But no.
Like, he could have used it on that. He could have... Wow.
Oh.
Wow.
Oh.
Just wow.
Okay. Interesting.
I mean, if
very Ysera, weird line of play.
Yeah, if Ysera does come down, I guess this will work out.
Yeah, I guess so. But I guess discount doesn't really matter if your control warrior is only worried about cards. Yeah.
Yeah, it's also not like like Handlock, for example, like they don't combo you really, but if they get too many Emperor hits off, then like the Sunwalkers and the Defenders of Argus get way cheaper. Whereas like even if like the Warrior's hand is decreased in cost, the defensive options don't get that much better.
Okay. Well, I'll be very surprised if we don't see an execute here. Do we want to possibly draw some cards with the Armistice first? And then Battle Rage after the Whirlwind effect takes place?
Oh, yeah.
Seems like a good plan.
Like double Armor Smith. Maybe even the Ghoul. No, wait.
Oh, no.
He can't Ghoul. He doesn't have the mana anymore. Goes with that.
Yeah, we need to play. What? Execute this card, watch mana. So, we do need to use it. But 3 cards is pretty sweet.
Yeah. Oskaga showing that he really knows what he's doing.
Well, Oskaga still has a Despite. He just needs to find Emperor now, and I think the whole world will be very, very clear.
Alright, ready for this.
Here we go! Armies of Stormwind!
Yep, the first ever Varian win ever in competitive play. Let's see it.
The Armies of Stormwind! What's it gonna be?
Okay. Sylvanas. Okay, that's good. Despite.
This
that was anticlimactic.
We're saying that a 7-7 draws two cards and summons a Sylvanas was not that good. It was disappointing.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, yeah, it's good, but it could have been even more, so.
Could have been so much more.
We have really high standards of us.
Oh. I mean, it is a 10 mana card. Like, 10 mana, summon 12-12 power and draw two cards is not enough for you guys? Man, yeah. Harsh.
Well, actually, this might have been better than if he summoned like some like random stuff, because like he does get the shield block, which is really important here.
Okay.
Host Kaga has everything he needs right now except for the Emperor, and no way to draw for it. Can he just go? He doesn't have Frothing either, and just the patrons. There's no way that's gonna be enough to kill the warrior, the control warrior.
Yeah, definitely need the cards to be cheaper, and definitely need to find the other frothing. I think the first frothing was used already, so yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was. Laid it on turn two with the coin. Is this another one of those plays where he just like leaves a minion at one HP? I think he must be going for it again.
I guess so. We could play the Drake Corsair here to soak up some damage, but it's not. Okay.
Well, it just soaks up the War Axe, which is not too huge of a deal.
Bash!
Yes.
More nice armor.
God. What do you guys think of that card?
I rated it pretty terrible because it's a 3-1 durability War Axe, right?
Mm-hmm.
But could be really good in certain matchups, like Hunter, for example.
It just like it puts into perspective how bad drain life is, and yes. I know at least one of us here has lost to a drain life deck before in competitive play.
Let's not talk about that.
Oh, Savish, do you want to tell a story?
Yeah, it was in China. Some Chinese guy.
Oh yeah, it was. Oh yeah, I remember that. Okay, and then
it's like a pretty important match too. I knew he was running that thing and. But the funny part is that it wasn't really that drain life that I lost, it was the Twisting Nether.
It was double Twisting Nether anti-hand boss.
I was playing Handlock against it, it was like, can't do much here.
Okay. Yeah.
It was basically two Twisting Nethers, like four Silences, two VGHs. And it was like anti-Handlock and anti-Hunter, if that makes any sense.
Okay. Mm. So are we saying that Bash is bad, or is it okay because it's just better than Dream Life?
I'm saying that it can beat Savitz.
Okay.
No. Come on, that's not fair.
Whoa, we're actually gonna do some patrons right now. Spawn two, and then spawn more.
Yeah. Spawn a lot.
The crowd is actually cheering for the patrons. Wow. Look at that. Okay. Wow.
You know, Bash is actually pretty good against patrons now that I think about it, because like normally the issue is oftentimes the patron warrior sets up four patrons and you can only deal with like two to three of them, but Bash gives you opportunity to deal with one extra.
Okay.
Yeah, and you can kill things like a patron behind an unstable cool.
Ooh. Oh, is that a little bit of a misplay? Shouldn't he just like swung with a swung trade at the patron and then whirlwind for one more patron before doing the last trade there? Yeah, I think Oscar missed the patron there.
Yeah, actually, I think
right. So. Yeah, that was actually a really big deal. Yeah.
I mean, you don't play around mind control tech, do you?
He traded a full HP patron for that. Shield Maiden, right?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
And then Whirlwind afterwards.
You don't want to Whirlwind when your opponent has a patron, obviously, but still, like, you know, just do that first.
So yeah, I mean, yeah, treat that one, but then, like, the other one, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, Life Coach is looking at a board of not too scary.
Yeah, but he can save the Brawl here. Just equip the Death Spite and hit the full HP patron. Equip the Fire War Axe afterwards.
Okay.
Or I'm sure there's some other ways you can do it too, but I think that's pretty cool.
Using Bash here would be pretty great as well.
And but he still needs to deal with the Warzone. It's pretty scary. I think he's gonna go with the fireworks.
Actually, you know what? I think not using the Bash is better. Because like Bash is like kind of an extra attack, like a wind fury.
Yeah, well, you can also just like whenever he sets up a second patron board, you can brawl and then bash it, I guess.
Oh yeah, that's
yeah, that's a full clear.
Alright, so looking for the Emperor. That's card draw, not exact. I mean, you could play the Acolyte, Ghoul, and then Whirlwind, so that the Ghoul actually draws an extra card. But at that point, you're wondering if you actually have enough combo to burst down your opponent, right?
Right.
I'm assuming that Whirlwind is going to be really important, because like both Deathbite of Oskaka has been used already.
Yeah.
Or has that been Life Coach's like Deathbite? I'm actually not really sure.
Oskaka used both as well.
Okay.
Oskaka needs both the Emperor and the Frothing from his deck still to win. But it's like, even then, so much armor for Life Coach.
Yeah.
Coach can even drink that Shield Maiden.
Yeah. How much armor, or rather, how many cards does Oskaka have right now left in his deck?
I mean, hopefully we can have production to check. It's seven. And yeah, Control Warrior doesn't really matter. It's never going to be more cards. Oh! Seems like yeah, this is time to make some patrons.
Yeah. So
with one Chroma Shell from Lethal.
I think with this play, he's saying that he like can't win normally, so he has to hope that Oskaka doesn't have an answer. And if he doesn't have an answer, there's like no way for Oskaka to win.
That's Lethal. Can you bash face?
Bash face?
It's Lethal with the Taskmaster. If you dream the Ghoul, if you can bash face, but I'm not sure. Can you use it on a minion?
You can dream a Ghoul.
What does the best text say? I think he missed Lethal.
Yeah, it says deal 3 damage. So
yeah, so you can use it on face. That was Miss Lethal.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. That is a Miss Lethal. Wow, who would have thought? Second Miss Lethal D.
That's alright. I think, like... Yeah,
like, both Miss Punish is 0% punish, right?
Yeah.
Oh my god. That's so gross.
To be fair, I think you do think harder when you're like in a unfavorable position and you miss lethal.
That's true.
Okay. Sure. And sometimes you just have a game plan, right? Where you just focus on, oh, I need to survive. My game plan is clear the board, and then the Patriot Warrior kind of just fizzles out, right? And yeah, sometimes you just miss the most logical thing. There's also the thing where, like, you know, mathematicians usually mess up on, like, the simplest calculations, like, you know, 1 plus 2, for example, right?
Yeah.
And then just does the harder ones, like, super easy. Yeah, so.
Yeah. I know Amaz and I, we both studied math, and we mess up all the time, right?
Yeah, all the time, man. Hearthstone arithmetic is, like, university PhD level.
Especially patron math, I mean, that's just crazy.
Patron math could be on the final exam.
But Twitch chat never misses lethal.
No.
Every time there's lethal, even when there isn't, there's chat lethal.
Yeah, so they have, Twitch chat has like 150% lethal.
Wow.
Right. Wow.
Well, Dr. Broom is pretty decent here, and Bash is actually going to make a little appearance.
Yeah, I think Ghost Gaga is gonna go for the little button at the bottom right corner here.
Mm-hmm. This is not it. You can draw a card and then you can okay.
Are his last cards just Frothing and Emperor of Warzone, the exact two cards he needs?
We have seen Thorsan for ages, and sometimes you just lose to that, right?
Yeah, there's been like situations where like if you don't draw the card, you like start to wonder whether you actually have it in the deck.
Yeah.
I know it at Assembly, one of the players, Vortex, he played Zoo for 3 games and he like got pretty, he got like 20 cards deep in each game and he never saw a Void Caller. So in his 3rd game, he was really stressing out about like whether he actually put them in his deck or not.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially if you're in the challenge screen, you cannot actually check your deck, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've had that happen with Druid. Do I have Wild Growth at all? I played so many games without drawing. I mean, there's like 5 games and I never saw a wild presence. I don't think.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, Life Coach is through today, and the head-to-head is a little bit more interesting now. We can actually see how it actually pans out. We have Hunter and Mage left for Nihilim, and we also have Hunter, but the Patron Warrior and Forsen's Zoo. Forsen played Zoo, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So I think the key here is, I think Osaka's Warrior will probably get a win. It's favored against both the Hunter and the Freeze Mage. Whereas the other decks, I think the Zoo is the deck from Forsen that will struggle, because more likely than not, both RDU and Tice's remaining decks will be favorable against the Zoo. Forsen was pretty unlucky in the sense that of the 4 decks that Nihilim has won with, 3 of them are unfavored against Zoo, like the Control Warrior, the Mech Shaman, and the mid-range Druid.
Mm-hmm.
And he just wasn't able to get it off there.
Have we seen Taisha's Mage yet? I don't think so.
No.
I think it's going to be a Freeze Mage. I know that Taisha really likes that deck. Firebat came to the conclusion that it's like really, really good in this format and in this meta. I came to the same conclusion. I think Thais might have also come to that conclusion. So did Forsen, by the way. He was also playing it. So I would be shocked if it was something like a Tempo Mage. It's possible. Like, Effigy is a good card in that, and Effigy can work in a lot of different mage lists. But again, has there really been enough time to perfect a new type of mage list?
I know that Nihilim is they really like Tempo Mage as well, RDU specifically, and RDU even convinced Tice to run a variation of his own Tempo Mage at Assembly. So there's still a possibility that it is some type of Tempo Mage.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just so good in this format, I think, because there's so few decks that counter it, and both of the teams are forced to bring 6 classes, there's a lot of good matchups. And also, Guess Arms are very unlikely. We haven't seen Guess Arms hardly ever in ATLC.
Yeah. One last thing about the Mage. I feel like in most of these Team League matches, teams bring like 1 curveball. And I feel like Nolum's curveball this series was that Control Warrior.
Yeah.
So I think in some respect, it's less likely that they'll bring a non-Freeze Mage.
Yeah, the Control Warrior really paid off as well. It's interesting. That sounds really some really heavy mind games from Nihilim coming out. Life got so well known for his patron gameplay.
Yep.
The Arduous Hunter. Let's see what traps. Are there any bears?
I don't know, but RDU like really loves the hybrid hunter, and more likely than not, we're gonna be seeing that.
Yeah, Leopard Gnome does seem like it.
Yeah. Do you guys think that the Ram Wrangler maybe? Belongs in that list? In the hybrid?
No.
I don't think so, because it's much more likely to belong in a mid-range list when you have the option to combine it with the Web Spinner on turn 6.
Right.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You probably, if you play that card, you want to run things like Snake Trap too. Maybe Snake Trap, Bear Trap. Have better chances to have those out when you need them.
Well, this Unstable Ghoul is stopping a lot of pressure from RDU. Just can't play anything else. Hmm.
Yeah. It just shows you why this matchup is so good for the Patron Warrior. And it's the record. My record says it's 26-16. So that's a 62% win rate for Warrior.
Okay.
That Unstable Ghoul is so good here. Like, the one card to deal with it easily would be Clive Zuga, but RDU doesn't have it.
Hmm. Wow, just an innocent looking 2-drop already causes this much deliberating from RDU.
You see it on RDU's face, he's like really, really unhappy about this ghoul.
I don't think anybody would be happy. Oh, well,
no.
There you go. Kind of have to do it. I mean, there's a thing where if a Acolyte of Pain gets to hide behind an unstable ghoul, you're even more sad. So even if this looks really bad, it's probably the best move.
Yeah, he had to choose between the bad players. Oh, whoa, that was a fast tackle.
Yeah, that was the fastest tackle I've ever seen.
I mean, it was really obvious. There was nothing else for him to do.
Not Huffer.
No, but yeah. That's like, I think that's fair. Because Leoc would have been even worse.
The thing is, it's not necessarily the middle option, because what always happens here is the Deathspite will kill off this companion, but if it's Leoc, you take 2 damage, if it's Misha, you take 4 damage, and if it's Huffer, you take 8 damage, so it's like actually slightly below average.
If you put it that way, yeah. It's average in terms of percentage drawn with the beast, right?
Mm.
Oh, man. Well. We should clear this Shredder, but we might want to play an Acolyte Pain before that happens, or we might even want to do something else.
Yeah, there's some options here.
Yeah, RDU definitely looks a little bit stressed. It is a bad matchup.
It is. And Ostgaga is Ostgaga is curving out so nicely here.
Mm-hmm.
The Deathspite and everything is just everything seems to be going Ostgaga's way for now. Wow, even Battle Rage.
Oh!
Oh!
Oh.
Wow! Oh, zero attack minion. Oh man. Oh, whoa. Okay, Cho is angry now. We can make him attack. But is that the best?
It might be, I don't know. It's hard to pass up a Lothib on 5.
Yeah, Lothib on 5 doesn't feel like it does that much, though.
Yeah, it's true. Like, it's just stuck behind. He could go, like, Clive Zuka and then Scientist clear off the ghoul before something like a Patron happens behind it. Because if he drops the Lothib and then there's Patron, he needs to top like a quick shot to deal with it.
Yeah. Not only that, but if you just drop the Lothab, there's a possibility, or like actually a very high likelihood, that you'll have to hit the ghoul with the Lothab. And that's just a lot of missing damage.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, this seems to make more sense.
Yeah, this also gives you the option to trade off your Lore Walker Cho. I feel like it's usually the player who gets Lore Walker Cho is at a disadvantage, because your opponent can always kill it, but you can't choose to kill it yourself.
Interesting. Choosing the call for the column here. Huh.
I think you don't mind giving your opponent Whirlwind, right?
Yeah, he's not going to play Whirlwind when you have like 5 patrons on the board, so that's fine, I think.
I wonder. Interesting.
Do you even mind giving your opponent Battle Rage?
I think you do. Because your opponent can always draw 1 card at least, and
oh yeah, that's true. They can draw 1 card. I forgot about the face.
Looks like he doesn't want to give anything away.
Yeah, looks like that.
Oh.
All right, and just clears off the Lore Walker Cho. That's not bad.
Okay.
That is all right.
I wonder. I see you.
All right, hopefully we are back. And yeah, like we said, you know, there's not much to do with RDU here. He can't really clear the he can't really clear any minions right now. So it's very awkward.
All right, I'm back. Hello.
Yep. Oh, it's actually Oskaka's turn right now. So Lothab has dropped. And we're gonna battle rage for 2. Just draw 2 cards. And do you actually clear this Lothab? I guess you do.
Yeah, it's pretty scary. Nej, yes, det var Armor Smith. Oh man, no way to deal with that. I mean, yeah, I guess he could unleash for one hit with weapon, but that's so bad.
Right.
Yeah. Can you like imagine how much worse like the bear trap would be here? Like it
yeah,
just seems pretty useless against patrons.
Yeah.
If you don't get it off on the first few turns.
Yeah, definitely does seem like that way. No, Emperor comes down too.
Alright.
There might be a way for RDU to actually win this if he actually draws his, what is it, second animal companion? So he can like Leoc into Unleash the Hounds and summon a lot of Hounds and then hero power for exactly 14.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's he's one way like to win.
Oh, he's actually...
Like Patron, Armorsmith, Whirlwind, Whirlwind or something. What is he thinking about?
Mm.
Yeah, I think that's exactly what he's thinking about, but that gets... It might get punished by Unleash. So
that is kind of weird that he just that Oscar just used the war song immediately, just froze it. I mean, I guess you want to figure out what kind of trap that is, but still, I mean, if you keep the war song up, these guys get charged and you actually get additional armor from the war song being alive.
It would have worked out like 1,000 times better to keep the war song around.
Right.
Could have frozen something else, but I guess he was expecting a different trap. It had to be that. He thought it was something else, something completely different. I'm not sure what he thought it would be, but
freezing. Alright, well, Knife Juggler comes down with Unleash. Not the best combo here.
Yeah. That's,
so what are you hoping for? You're hoping for two knives to the armor serve and then three knives to the face. Yeah?
Such a bad situation here. He could unleash once and then like throw two dogs into them, Armorsmith, then go for a second unleash. I don't know.
Hmm.
He could just get like the most lucky juggles ever. They all go to face.
Okay.
Or some like go to the Armorsmith first.
Well, here we go. Actually, he also play Unleash the Hounds by itself, right? And just like clear that way. But nope, let's go for the juggles.
You know, also at a certain point. Oh wow.
Ooh.
But you know what? At a certain point, the like the patrons stop spawning.
Is that a good thing? Oh, that's a good one.
Did you roll?
I think he roped out.
Oh man. Oh, he didn't get the Armorsmith killed.
Wait, it's still going. This is still going. Wait, are these turners taking forever? Oh
what?
My god! Whoa!
Oh man!
Oh man! Still what going!
Mess.
What is Oscarga's turn?
Nothing.
Oh! Well. Oh man.
There's some epic sax in the background.
Yeah, you guys thought that Pedro took a long time, right? Here's the new Miracle Hunter. Alright. And and the contingency. Well then, that was an interesting development.
I think optimally, all of the patrons would have gone to one health, and then he could have cleared them all off with the hounds at the end.
Okay, optimally, but then I guess, you know, the the knife juggler animation. Along with the patron sync, everyone getting here, along with the hound crashing it in, that just takes too much time.
Yeah. But like, definitely props to RDU for knowing to go for that kind of play, for like knowing that it had the potential to work.
Yeah. The 0.01% chance to work.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Well, it's tied up. All right, good. So Oskaka is due for the day. Each person has one deck left, and now we have hunters on both sides. And of course, Forsen's Warlock and Taisha's Unknown Mage. We expect it's Freeze Mage, but who knows? Yeah, it's still up in the air.
Yeah, if it's Freeze Mage, I have to give Nalum the advantage here. And okay. I also... that being said, I think Chalky might have the advantage in the Hunter Mirror since he is running the Worgen Infiltrators, so he's like the faster deck.
Right. But like you said, it seems like Forsen's Zulok is like the weak link here.
Yeah, good better OP. But it can, like, with the right draw, if he curves out nicely with it, he might be just fine.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't see all the tech cards in there. What did he take out for them? The Impaler, for example. Did he take out something like low tap? Because if he took out the low tap for it, he's going to have a bad time against the freeze mage.
Mm-hmm. But I guess we don't know, but the Impaler is definitely something to be careful of. I mean, I'm pretty sure after the match, Nihilim went like, oh, there's a Gormok, there's a forces running Gormok, always reduce minions down to like really, really low, right?
Yeah,
you can't really play too much around that though, because Zoo is always going to get four minions eventually.
Yeah,
and but I guess you can on turn four.
Yeah, I kind of, I think it plays more of a role in Paladin, where you can't play around it with Paladin because they have, like, what, Murloc Knight, Silverhand Regent, they just press the hero power, and then they have a whole board, and then they can Gormok, for example. But for Warlock, sometimes you can, right? Sometimes you go like, oh, I don't want to kill this Haunted Creeper. But then, because he's playing Gormok, I want to kill it off before that happens, you know? So you could play around it a little bit.
Yeah,
of course.
Oh, here, that's a good matchup that Forsen actually got. The Warlock versus the Hunter, obviously. Since we're expecting Freeze Mage, Warlock really needs to win here to dodge that matchup. It's not a good matchup here, but it's definitely better than the Freeze Mage matchup.
He has an awesome starting hand.
Oh yeah, this is this is actually very close to the dream.
Yeah, it is.
Now we just need to get, like, I don't know, Void Terror.
Oh, even the Void Caller. It's not like the perfect thing right now, but it's a card that can be very, very powerful later on.
Right.
So you can put, like, you know.
It is actually very sick.
It is.
RDU is going to be playing a Mad Scientist and he's gonna concede the abusive sergeant to the Voidwalker.
Mm-hmm.
Forsen draws a Flame Imp, but Egg is gonna pop down here. And yeah, Forsen actually draws another 1-drop next turn. It's gonna be amazing. Oh, wow. Yeah. Actually trading here. That might be good.
Yeah, it might be. Like, he knows there's freezing traps.
Oh, I actually really like the trade here, now that I think about that.
So you can use the 1-1 freezing trap then.
Yeah.
Trade.
Wow. Well, we'll see what trap it is. It's freezing traps, because the freezing trap does not have a green border around it. Exactly, so, and oh my god, Horse is gonna have a very insane turn here.
Yeah. Wow.
Wow. Oh,
that's a great draw with the Void.
Oh, Forsen, very smart there.
Yeah,
I would say that play was about 140 IQ.
Yeah, might be a game-winning play right there. The way that this game would have panned out if he didn't do the trade, it would have been completely different.
Mm-hmm. That was a very good play. Well, RDU is not running out of steam yet. Shredder into Lothab into possibly a Shredder trap.
Yeah,
here we definitely ignore the Shredder, right? I mean, do we actually take the trade?
You're winning the race.
Right. And then, of course, all your minions on the board trade with the Shredder, right? So you don't have to, like, purposely, you know, do that.
Yeah. Exactly. Like, there's no good trades being offered to the Shredder.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is looking so good for Forsen. He can, next turn, potentially, he can even, if the Shredder goes face, he can just play the Voidwalker out of his hand and guarantee to get the Doom God.
Alright. And what drops here? Oh, Ooze. Okay, that's above average.
Ooh.
Oh.
Well, not too bad, I guess.
Yeah, I guess you can just like take the Valley Trade here and just go for phase.
Mm.
Man, two Void Callers with a Doom Guard in your hand.
Yeah.
Actually helps out the Voidwalker a lot, right? Voidwalker is frozen, you don't really want it to pop out. And, RDM might be just looking to go face here, since there's no way to get back from the board.
He's losing the race so bad, though.
Yeah. It's just generally in this matchup, like, the Mad Scientist gets a lot more value off, other than just trading, essentially. He traded for a 1-1 and then a Flame Imp, which is, like, good, but it's like not what you expect in this matchup.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Yeah. So here, unfortunately, Forsen's gonna take another freezing trap hit, but We have like a lot of defensive cards. Argus is insane against Hunters. But yeah, it looks like Forsen really wants to force out. He should actually track the trap first, right? He might be afraid that it's a bear trap actually. So that you actually want the Void Walker to go out.
Try.
Yeah, maybe. Nope. Gonna go for display instead.
I wonder.
Yeah.
You can just
Alright, so ordering matters here. Gotta choose a little bit quicker, Forsen.
Yeah, go. Go, go, go.
Have silence there.
Let's see what he gets.
The Doomguard would be Jin.
You got it is the Doomguard.
Yeah, it is Doomguard.
Oh, there you go. Perfect.
Oh, nice. Doomguard went face. That's pretty good. It's pretty crazy, actually. Oh.
Jin Squire. The Warlock's still at 24, can you believe it?
Wow.
No. Argent Squire is an interesting one. I know Purple Drank really likes Argent Squire.
Yeah.
In Hunter. Mm-hmm. But it's I think it's pretty good in this matchup. You just need to draw it early because right now it's pretty dead.
Yeah, it is. It goes well with Oh, that's the Impaler.
Oh yeah. See, it's actually very, very difficult to get that many mins on the board. But hey, at least you can have some Argus value.
Mm-hmm. True.
And I guess the trades are not really too relevant for you, so I guess you just go face after Argusing.
Yeah. Interesting. This, well done by RDU, they're making those yeah. weird trades.
Ooh, six to the face. Abusive, does that help?
No, it does.
I think so.
Well, it. At least you can clear off the
yeah,
the impaler.
Right. But then you can't clear off. Well, actually you can clear the whole board, but you have to use your kill commander feature.
Unfortunately, no beast. Like what RDU really wanted there was a beast, so he could have just killed commander for 5.
Yeah, exactly. Wow, seems like Forsen has really, really ahead here. And RDU is just top decking. I guess RDU could get a lot of quick shots and come back in the game.
Yeah, it has to be a lot of creatures. How many creatures can there be? Well, two.
One can dream, one can dream.
So basically, RDU has to be cheating.
Oh. Okay. Never heard of that before. Nope. Knife Juggler is pretty good. We'll take one of those. Oh, wow.
It's not going for it.
Oh, it's actually going for phase. I like this play. Oh man, even though you don't have lethal, you're bluffing it.
Well, you have a very good opportunity to kill out these 1-1s or 2-1 and the 1-1 with knife jugglers next turn. Ooh. Does he get slightly punished here?
That's a slight punish.
Yeah.
But then, of course, you are missing just the second Doomguard, the power of whelmings, a second power of whelming.
So many things.
Don't get that. You do get slightly punished. All right, let's try again. Is it this card? Yep! It's that card! And Forsen is actually getting Zulok out of the matchup. And it's going to be amazing because he's actually going to dodge the Freeze Mage. That is so huge.
That was an important win for Forsen, Forsen and the boys.
Forsen and the boys.
No, it sounds like a band.
Wow. Forsen's
I've actually noticed in the team league with that, so a lot of the time, Yeah, I've noticed a lot of times it comes down to like 4-4 and like both teams have like one favorable matchup that they have to pick and one unfavorable matchup, and it kind of becomes a coin flip here. So right now Nilum is in a pretty bad position with just the hunter from Chalky, and like Chalky is known as like pretty much the best hunter player in the world.
Arguably, but definitely seems like Force and Boys has a big edge.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's true what you said, Monk, that Chalky is favored in the Hunter mirror, having both that and the mage remaining.
Well, you know what? Because RDU is running Squires in his Hunter deck, maybe he's favored? Because we don't see high mains from his deck either. Like, it seems Yeah, it seems like they're running the same deck, but with Squires and Worgen Infiltrators reversed.
Yeah, Squires are pretty good against like the Labor Gnomes and stuff. There's so many of those one drops. Yeah, it can be really helpful if he gets it on out early.
Oh man, but this is pretty important as the winner of this series faces Tempestorm in the winner's bracket, and from there, whoever wins that will advance to the finale directly to join Valuetown and Cloud9, which are obviously in the finale due to them being first place and second place in phase one. And of course, the losers will have to face against Team Archon in the loser's bracket for a chance to basically stay alive. And Hillam already played a redemption series coming in from this, so they definitely don't want to, you know, put themselves in the spot where they're on the chopping block.
Oh yeah. League has been really tight. I mean, Nihilum were I believe they were at first for quite a while, but just in the last couple of weeks, they fell all the way down to the Redemption tournament. They did beat Team Liquid in the Redemption match, and now they're here. But if they lose this match and they lose again tomorrow, it was all for nothing.
All right. Chucky's obviously going to Hunter, but we're waiting for Nihilum to choose which deck they want to actually go against this first, and it's going to be the mage. So actually, interestingly enough, in day one we're going to see everybody's deck list. There's no deck list that's going to be secret. Of course, we're not going to show any deck list just yet. We're going to show all the deck lists after the whole phase two is finished. Mm-hmm. So you know, players will have to go by the past broadcast to actually see like what cards are in these decks.
Doesn't it actually make more sense for Nihilum to play the Hunter so that there's a possibility for the Mage not to be seen for the next match?
Yeah, that's true. But then at the same time, it's like a bad spirit to go around playing to lose, right? You get what I mean? Like, if you don't get advantage if you win, but you have a disadvantage if you lose, then it's kind of sort of playing into losing. And that might not be the, mindset you want to put yourself into.
But was it under your bench, maybe? No?
Oh, no, this last match, it doesn't really matter.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. All right, so this matchup, Hybrid Hunter against Freeze Mage, heavily favors Hybrid Hunter with a score of 14-4, so that's 78%.
Wow, that's brutal. But Tesh does have an Ice Barrier. That's a pretty good start. Also has a Mad Scientist, and maybe pitch everything else after that. You're just really looking to survive, right?
Yeah, I've heard different opinions on whether you keep the Ice Barrier here, and we see Tice actually throws it away. I think everyone agrees that you keep it against Face Hunter, and most people would say that you don't keep it against mid-range, is what I've heard, but the hybrid is like the more questionable one.
Yeah, I mean, hybrid, the definition is a mix between the two, so hard to tell.
He had the scientist already, so that might be like why he really wanted to throw it away. It feels like, okay, I'm going to get the barrier from the scientist anyway. Mm-hmm. So let's increase our chance to find the card. So.
Okay, coin ping is definitely the right play. Mad Scientist, you know, doesn't really do much. This coin ping basically makes a 1-1 charger. And Chucky, on the other hand, not too much, but the owl might come in handy later.
Well, turn to Hero Power Pass. That is so bad for the Hunter. It's so important. Now the other mages are here on board.
Yep.
Something like a juggler on turn 2 would have probably added up to like 9 damage or so.
This is a little bit of a good thing. Well, oh man, double ice block drawn already. That's not good.
No, not at all.
You want to ping here, and you also want to cast Arcane Intellect here, so, well, you gotta pick something.
I would probably lean towards the Arcane Intellect, because there's nothing to do next turn. Well, I guess you can do the Arcane Intellect next turn, but it's like, you could have picked up another Scientist and still went with the ping.
Mm-hmm.
So you could like have a Loot Hoarder, or Frostbolt, and the ping for next turn.
Yeah, and you pay 2 damage for that, basically, for that chance.
Yeah. Exactly, like two health.
Oh, Doomsayer is going to come down, and actually is going to buy Tesh a turn. Well, at least looking by his hand.
Stops the the animal companion here.
Doesn't stop the eagle horn bow. Eagle horn bow goes face.
Yep. Like the best thing you can do on this turn. Also, if he had all the cards possible, the eagle horn bow was most likely the best one. I mean, okay, maybe an owl, but outside of the owl.
Ooh, best beast synergy.
Beast synergy.
That barrier is a really good card to draw. Should buy him more time.
He definitely needs more cards, though, I feel. Like, his hand isn't really going to cut it here, because it's all, like, secrets, and he needs basically clears for the rest of the game, like, I feel.
Yeah, but also, if you don't do the barrier right now, his life total might go too low, where the barrier doesn't even get popped anymore, and, like, Chucky can just pop him without proking the barrier.
Mm-hmm. That's actually very true, too. We're actually saying that, 19 health is actually very low.
Yeah,
too much damage.
There's a lot of damage coming in right now.
Yeah. Well, let's use the abuser first. Raptor doing 7 damage is effectively going to remove the ice barrier. And we also have a creeper behind it. Mm-hmm. Some AoE protection. And Force and Force is looking pretty good. Taj needs something. Anything. Blizzard would be nice.
Frost fireballs at it.
So he can Arcane Intellect into
a Frost Nova, maybe? I mean, I'm not really sure if that is even good.
It's okay. He might pick up like a Blizzard or Flamestrike afterwards. Okay.
I don't think the situation is that dire yet, since he does have 2 Ice Blocks and Alexstrasza in his hand.
Okay.
Plus, he can always leverage his ping. And in addition, Chalky has 1 card in his hand.
Alright, well, we'll see what happens with Tesh's draw here. I think it's going pretty bad. The turn you Alexstrasza is the turn you're not actually drawing anything. Whoa, okay, there's a Flamestrike.
That's pretty good.
It is.
That might lead him to Ice Block instead of pinging here.
I think pinging is the way to win, though.
It's pretty interesting.
Again, yeah. Yeah, he has to decide whether he'll have enough mana to play an Ice Block eventually, and how much he values that 3, potentially 4 damage with a possible Leok.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so Leok and Hoffer are like almost the same in this situation. That is the one bad animal companion.
Chucky does not feel too happy about that move.
Yeah. It's the one bad one.
I wonder if there's gonna be a 4th animal companion in a later expansion. That would be very cool.
Oh my.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is actually really close.
Oh yeah. Well, okay, so what do you do here? Do you just Ice Block and then just like hold? Because you either Ice Block into Alexstrasza, which you probably die, or you Flame Strike this turn and cross your fingers, not hope for 2 damage, and then establish Ice Block next turn. Whereby probably die.
Thinking like Frostbolt the Misha and being one of the abusives, then get the Ice Block up. Because after that, there's only 6 damage coming in. So if there's if Chucky throws a minion, the Ice Block, it will hold up.
Huh, actually,
like,
you know what?
Not a Charger minion, like
non-charged. Yeah. Nah, still very difficult. You're put in such a bad spot here. The Ice Block just practically has to live, right?
Yeah, we just gotta hope for the best.
Okay.
There's so many cards in Chucky's deck that would pop the point.
I think it's pretty much about half, like, the 3 weapons that are left, and the 2 kill commands.
Right.
And a possible quick shot, animal companions.
Ooh! Wow. That's painful! Oh, man! Oh! The match you really need to win, but it's not gonna be easy.
Thais is gonna be so happy to see the trap go up.
No, the trap is probably not even gonna go up, right? I mean, what if it's a anti killbot? Oh, never mind. Okay, sure. Like, what if it's an anti killbot and then Frost Nova this turn?
Cold.
Yeah, that's the Tice tech in Freeze Mage.
Oh, that's actually really sick.
Yeah, no one else really uses it, but yeah, it's pretty amazing here.
Okay, well, we'll see if Alexstrasza is going to make a difference. I'm pretty sure this... Whoa.
Yeah, Lutz Hodder, Gun of Gold being.
Yeah.
Next turn, Alex Strasser seems. Oh.
Oh!
Well, I guess you can do that too.
You could. And then Alex Strasser next turn brings yourself up to, say.
So it's like, do you want to see four spectral thingies, or do you want to see two 1/1s with Death Rattle?
Yeah.
He could also have the loot order, but it's like, it's just getting frozen. Interesting.
Alright.
Looks like he's
gonna go with Flame Strike, yeah.
Yep.
Alright, what does Chalky want to see here? A minion.
Quick shot.
Oh! Man. These draws from Chalky have been pretty abysmal.
Yeah.
And now Alexstrasza's gonna set Tiger's life to 15. That's pretty much a very, very obvious play. Whoa.
I feel like he's going for the ice block. He wants to clear as much as possible. Because now if you... I don't know. Maybe you should
clear as much as possible. And then Alexstrasza. Yeah, that actually is pretty good too.
I can keep it.
Alright.
There's not gonna be any more icebox left, no.
Chalky needs a minion. Okay.
Oh no, he gets it!
Oh man! Oh.
Most exciting minion in the game.
Exactly. Well, 5 damage on the board means Chalky needs to top deck quite a bit of damage. And Oh! Wow!
Yeah, never mind.
Wow, what a turnaround. Wait. Tai is thinking about healbot, huh?
No, you Alex, of course you Alex.
You
can healbot afterwards. There's no way that after healing the 15, he can take, maybe like 7, but then just healboting through it.
Oh man, but this is such a high pressure situation, right? You don't really know what you're doing. Anymore, I guess. Like, there's no other chance where Alexstrasza is gonna heal for 14. There's like no. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, Alexstrasza.
But sometimes you start to second guess yourself and. Oh!
Wow.
Oh man. What is happening?
Yeah.
Oh no? Okay.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. Oh wow! A chain of terrible jaws for Chalky.
Yeah. So if Chalky still is going with the philosophy of only 2 traps in his deck, then that means Mad Scientist is useless.
Probably.
And not only that, even if it were any other trap besides maybe Bear Trap, it would be useless because the Freeze Mage just really doesn't care about other traps.
Right. Wow, this is also very abysmal because Anti-Killbot is going to pop down and then Taj is going to have all the life in the world.
Yeah, he can Frost Nova Anti-Killbot and then get the Anti-Killbot back even.
Oh my god. Yeah. Well, it's not over yet, guys. This is gonna possibly go to a final game. How exciting.
Seems very likely at this point.
And if it is the final game, it's gonna be a Hunter Mirror. Just Hearthstone personified.
Of course.
Like, Chalky could potentially draw into a quick shot into something. Then he could quick shot there. And the kill, but then a quick shot into Eaglehorn bow, that would be 5 damage on base. Well, that's good.
Oh, that's it. That's just absolutely brutal.
Yeah.
So brutal.
Okay, just insult to injury.
Alright, I think this is good enough.
Yeah.
The freeze mage just went up back to like full health.
Back to 30. Back to 30.
Wow. Well. this is just funny.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what he's thinking about. But there's a lot on the line. Maybe he wants to sequence those somehow, like first Frostbolt and Ping, and we test if there's another secret, get more information for the next game. Just in case there is one more secret.
Wow. Nope. 2 freezings and that's it.
That's very valuable information for the team.
Oh man, how what a turnaround!
Yeah,
like you said, Mongoose. how much of a percent favorite?
The Hunter is 78% favorite.
Well, I think we need to drop that percentage a little bit now.
Yeah.
Oh man, final game. This is hype. I'm excited.
Hype. You know what is even more hype? Again, it's a Hunter Mirror, the matchup that we most love to see in the entire game.
Exactly.
It's going to be a lot of SM working.
And didn't we say that the Hunter lists were very similar? I would actually have to give the edge to RDU here. He has the Aryan Squire. Aryan Squire kills two things.
Yeah, it's true. Although the Worgen Infiltrator does race a little better, I'd say.
Well, I mean, in a lot of mirror matchups, it's actually a lot of trading involved, right?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Like, especially in the aggressive mirror matchups, it's surprisingly all about board control.
Oh, man. This is... No, it all comes down to this. Every class is a checkmark, but one Hunter will be left behind.
So yeah, much on the line right now.
One Hunter to rule them all.
Yeah. For a $250,000 tournament, this is pretty much the most exciting Hunter game. The Hunter Mirror, you're going to see.
Yeah, I think no other Hunter Mirror in the history of Hearthstone has had more on the line. I'll go as far as to say that.
And again, it's RDU for the last spot, right? Like Nihilim loves putting RDU in like the chopping block.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah, especially in the beginning of the matches. Yeah, the team league, exactly. He was always the last, and he usually had like three or four matches to win, but he pulled through in the end.
Oh, here we go.
Yeah.
All comes down to this. Today's been really exciting. It always has come down to the final game.
Oh, right. Wow. Whose hand
Chucky's
is that?
Hand looks spectacular. RDA hands, well, he has a one drop, but obviously I'm happy with that.
Yeah, he's like, he's also just like, just judging from his opening hand, he looks so distressed.
Yeah. Oh, man. There's so much stress on the line. Jesus.
One of these hands is way better than the other one.
Yeah.
Looks like
Haunted Creeper is really good, but three of the cards in Chalky's hand are really good.
Oh, man. Alright, so what do here? Seems like a Leprechaun is actually the best play.
Yeah. Now a top deck Clive Zuka for RDU. That would be so good.
Oh wow, Unleash is a really good card in this matchup too.
Yeah.
So Abusive is definitely going face. Alright, it's a race and facing is the place. Okay, back over to Chalky, picks up Animal Companion, okay. Man, this is just so close. This is amazing.
Yeah. I think the one play or the one problem with Chalky's hand is that he isn't gonna be able to use the coin that effectively.
Okay. But still,
we're probably gonna see like a turn 4 coin, for example, and that's
is this Humper?
Humper!
Oh.
Humper!
Oh man!
That's not the time for Humper.
Man, brutal! Absolutely brutal. And RDU actually might want to trade this because otherwise the Mad Scientist trades with the Huffer and then a Frisian Check comes in. So RDU is still making the right moves. Oh man.
Yeah, so essentially this Mad Scientist on its own will do around 5 damage. 2 to the Huffer, 2 to the Haunted Creeper, and then 1 to the one of the remaining spiders that is bounced back.
Okay, so is it first Huffer time? It's only fair, right? It's only fair.
But you know what? One of these Huffers is much better than the other.
Yep. Okay, it's a freezing trap, right? Freezing trap. Yeah, we know that. Yep.
It's a freezing.
Let's run it back. Actually, Leok might be the best one here, right?
Yeah, he needs a
Leok. Oh, yeah, Leok would be the best
one. No. He was the third Huffer!
Oh my god!
What?
Wow!
Wow!
Fighting back.
Absolutely brutal. Oh my god.
It's still alright. Lothab brings it back. It's such a close game.
Yeah, it really is. Both players have exactly the same life total, too.
Wait, we're gonna see Arcane Golem charge face here, right? Actually, Arcane Golem clear. I don't mind that either. You got a Knife Juggler as well. Holy.
Yeah, I don't mind it either. Since especially since like these hunter decks, they curve pretty lowly, so like you don't mind as much about giving your opponent mana.
Mm-hmm. Oh man, Chalky with the two Glazukas. It's not gonna work out. It's like it's so dead right now.
Normally it's such a good card in this matchup, but right now it's just doing nothing.
Wait. Artie is going face. Artie's going face. Is there gonna be a leash?
That would punish him. You know what the problem was this game? Chalky had too much of a good thing. He had too many like low tier plays.
Oh, yeah.
Oh wow. Can't even kill command the Leok. You have to like what? Kill command the Arcane Golem and try and fight back for the board that way. And then you what?
So bad.
You don't even establish anything behind it.
How do you win when you start kill commanding Arcane Golems?
Holy.
You have to like play the Abusive Sergeant just as a creature as well.
Yep.
Well, looks like the play.
Looks like the play.
Yeah.
Oh man.
So let's imagine if RDU had actually traded.
Uh-huh.
Then he would have the Leok would be safe then, right?
Yeah, the Leok would be safe. But then RDU is pushing another 4 damage. With the Arcane Golem. Oh!
That's a really tough call. I would not have had the balls.
Ooh.
Oh my god. No, this is pretty over. This is over.
This is completely over. Okay, you bow Hero Power and then next turn Knife Juggler Unleash and you win.
Yeah, that's it. The only thing I can see is Chalky abusiving RDU's Aryan Squire and then getting like Vitality Totem off the Shredder. Like that's literally the only way.
Alright. I was gonna say the only way, maybe, I don't know, like, even if you somehow replay the load depth, it wouldn't be enough.
Yeah. Oh.
Okay.
That's the only way I see it. Alright, let's kill see command it. Your own, you can also kill command your own Shredder after attacking, but okay. That might let's not be it. Even enough.
Let's see if he sees it.
Oh man, yeah, there he sees it. No, wow, wow! The villain takes it!
Wow, so clutch.
Oh, RDU takes it. Oh my god.
Wow. Impressive.
Yeah, and you know what? Those were just really close games. Both our matches today were 6-5s, and our match last week between Nilum and Liquid was also a 6-5. So Nilum, they're like just winning by the skin of their teeth every single time.
What a series. That was very exciting for me.
Yeah, that's really entertaining. Just all the way through,
mm-hmm.
coming down. We were predicting when forcing points were up 5-4. We were predicting, Chalky has this. Like, no, nothing can go wrong there. But just like that, two games in a row. Like maybe a little bit of bad draws against the freeze mage at first, and that one Chalky had a good draw. But it's just like things didn't line up. He didn't get to use those play bazookas very well.
If we look back at the standings, I mean the bracket, hopefully we can get that up on the screen ASAP. We can actually see that Temple Storm and Nihilum are actually going to face tomorrow in the winner's bracket. And of course, whoever wins that series is going to advance to the finale in September 11 to 13. And then, of course, only one team of Forsen Boys and Archon are going to have a chance to play for the last spot. And Forsen Boys and Team Archon, they're not going to be both going to the finale. Only one of them are going to go through.
Yeah. And another key point is that all four teams have to use the exact same deck lists as they did before. So what teams can actually do for tomorrow, or rather today, is that they can just like look up the games from their next opponents, rebuild the deck list, and get like three practice partners to just like do like demo runs of tomorrow's matches.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like a good way to practice. Did I just give Archon some ideas?
I mean, you're giving everybody some ideas, right?
Okay.
But it seems like that's very important. With $250,000 on the line, that would be a very good strategy to take for today, since tomorrow's matches will actually begin in how many hours? I'm bad at math. 17 hours from now. That's actually not a lot of time, right? Just 10 hours of sleeping, that's like 7 hours of game time.
Yeah, you better be efficient with your time. You really want to study those deck lists as much as you can at this point. It's very important. There's so much on the line, like it's been mentioned many times.
Yeah.
Like you have those 7 hours after sleeping. You better make it count.
Yeah, especially against like the weird deck list from Eloise and 6-0, right?
Yep.
Like you now that you know them, the deck list that is, their strategies are going to be much less powerful and can learn to predict what they're going to bring. So I think that's almost about it today. We have to thank our sponsors once again, Alpha Draft for fantasy esports for cash. You can create your own Archon Team League fantasy teams on Alpha Draft. And of course, the Amazon App Store where I get all my Hearthstone packs. Savitz and Amaz, I believe it's time for shoutouts. Savitz, do you have any final shoutouts for the day?
Thanks to Amaz for having me cast. It was a pleasure. The matches were really awesome. I've been watching the show anyway, but it's just I enjoy casting a lot. So, just yeah. Thanks to Amaz, and that's it.
Aw, that's really nice of you. Well, yeah, I want to thank all the teams actually for participating in ATLC. It's going to be awesome, and can't wait to see tomorrow's matches where you know more teams are going to be decided. We have one team going to the finale for sure, and one team eliminated for sure in sixth place. And then, of course, we have Friday as well for the final game to determine the fourth and final spot of the finale. I guess shout out to the production crew. And we will see you guys tomorrow, right?
Yeah, we'll see you guys tomorrow. It's been really exciting. And we'll be back right here tomorrow, same time, with some fresh, all-new TGT decks. See you then.